Conservation Commission meeting is called to order, and it's being recorded for RCTV. You can find it at Comcast Channel 99 or Verizon Channel 32. Videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob, and check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. The first item on the agenda at 7 o'clock is a request for determination of applicability for 2017-09-1321 Main Street, MAP 51, Lot 89, Shaw Realty Trust. Hi, Jack. Are you here representing?
I am. I'm representing Shaw Realty Trust. I'm here with Terry Shaw, who's in the back row. And basically, back in 2009, the Shaw family made some improvements to this site. They put in a new dumpster enclosure. They did a bunch of work, and at that time, the wetlands was delineated by Leah Basbane. Now, fast forward to 2017, the parking lot is in need of repair. To the point that they're going to have to excavate out the existing pavement, grade out the gravel beneath, and then repave the surface. So we met with Chuck before we got going with this, and he recommended that he'd like to see some sort of drainage because there is no formal drainage system associated with this site. And it could be low impact, and specifically, yes, if we could do some type of rain garden. When I went out to the site, we did some additional survey work and was showing a 3 foot wide by 12 inch deep crushed stone trench to be installed along the edge of the parking lot with a rain garden. And if you went out for your site walk, presently there's a high point here, the water flows back and then it runs off through a little channel here out to the wetland area. So by putting in this crushed stone trench, it'll collect water. It's going to range between 2 and 6 inches deep, and then there'll be a rain garden here. It's a small rain garden, but there's a number of plantings, and when water reaches a certain level, it'll go out to this trench, and it'll continue the same drainage pattern that it always has. The parking lot itself, the pavement area, will not be expanded upon. It'll be reconstructed in the same footprint as you see now, and all site grades will be within 1 to 2 inches of what you see on the site now. I do show, back in 2009, we did show how the parking lot would be striped, and they'll look to stripe the plan, the parking lot in accordance with my plan. And that's about it. I tried to show the tree line. If you went out for the site walk, there's a good amount of room between the edge of pavement and the tree line. So in order to construct the rain garden, to make these site improvements, there's no trees that will have to be cut. Only limited grading, and I do show an erosion control mulch sock to be staked at the limit of work line, but there'll be no trees cut as part of this project.
Jack, what's the base of the rain garden? What do you put in?
I have a construction detail shown at the bottom of the plan, but basically, it shows it right there. And I've used it on a number of sites. It's basically a 2 to 3 inch mulch, hardwood mulch base. And then there's a planting soil mix, 18 inches of planting soil mix. So the mulch helps keep everything moist. I've used it on probably 4 different sites in town, and we've had good success with it.
Yeah, I often take my bike through the Ravens, taking it over the track. With the mulch, have you seen any erosion in any of your rain gardens?
I have not.
Okay. And I think that one's been in for a couple of years.
Right. Yeah. And after heavy rains, I do go over to look at Ravens once in a while to see how it's holding up, and it looks good. But on this is only going to be, it's only going to be a foot deep, the rain garden, and it's not going to be a steep, you know, we're not going to have a steep slope into it, so I think it'll stay pretty stable.
Any questions from the commission members? We did, I did not visit the site, but I think, Chuck, you've been out there, correct?
Yes. I have, I did, I, yeah, Jack said, I did notice, I think it's quite apparent where the runoff is going right now. I did have a question, Jack, do you think that the crushed stone area is kind of enough of a deterrent to prevent anyone from driving into it?
Yes.
Driving into it?
Well, yeah, I mean, what, how high is it off the pavement? Is it, is there like a visible barrier to it, or?
You mean someone driving off into like the rain garden area?
By accident, maybe just backing up and backing into it, or?
Right, without a curb.
Taking the corner wide.
Yeah, well.
It shouldn't have a curb, it's gonna wash, it's gonna sheet.
Yeah, and it's gonna run into it, yeah.
Well, there's no parking spaces over here, this is just a travel way, so no one should be backing into it, but if someone went wide, I guess they, but the crushed stone trench is 3 feet wide. They'd have to really veer off course to head towards the rain garden. And I thought of trying to put a berm in, but drainage comes, I'm trying to introduce water into this system, and there is water coming through this area here. So I didn't want to create a problem with a berm either.
Maybe it's a.
It could be a spot where we put in like a wooden guardrail or something between the rain garden
maybe
and
that's
the
more
trench.
For like the building department, but just a little visible guardrail so that people have something to tap before they go into the woods.
Right.
I wonder if some painting of the paved lot could happen in that area too. You know, it's not a guarantee, like a guardrail would be. And a guardrail would be preferable, but because that'll still allow sheet flow. But just a visible painted line is also a low-tech warning to drivers not to drive off pavement in that area.
Right. How deep is that again, Jack?
The swale's only going to be 2 to 6 inches deep.
Okay.
But we're not opposed if you think a wooden guardrail makes sense, it probably does.
The swale, it says 2.5 on here?
It should say 2-inch/6-inch.
Oh, that's an inch.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah.
I have a question about snow removal. Do you have some thoughts about how during the wintertime snow is going to get pushed around this site?
Let me ask Terry, can you take that question?
I can. The stone removal in the back lot, it goes to the right and the left of the dumpster area.
Okay.
For the most part.
Okay.
None of it gets pushed towards that area only because of the drainage. We've had that problem where snow's gotten there, and then the parking lot is flooded because the water couldn't get out. So it's all directed towards that dumpster area.
Okay. I've seen even with my neighbors with their own contracted plow people, you know, damage happens, you know, things that they go off the paved area and parts of gardens or parts of walls get taken out. And, you know, it'd be nice if these features were protected from that, to protect your investment in them and to protect their function. Just want to bring that up.
I know the swale is trying to get everything back this way, but you know, also offer some pretreatment before it gets into that rain garden. Is there any thought of extending it up any further, or?
We could actually extend it right along the limit, right up towards the front of the site.
Yeah,
it's probably a good idea to do that.
Oh.
I'm not sure why I stopped it originally. I think because I only had the rain garden going to here, so and I knew there was a high point, but I think it might make sense as water flows, we could have this, if you want to make it a condition that the trench extends
kind of
to the front of the site, it makes sense to me.
Is any water going to go in it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so everything's draining from that direction to the rain garden, you know, from up there to the rain garden. So.
It'll depend on the storm intensity, I think. But
yeah.
It's got
no,
a chance.
Where there's no curb line in a high-intensity storm, some would flow off this way as well.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I think it would make sense. It's not that much more for Terry to put it in, and I think it would work well.
Yeah. I agree.
Any other questions from the members of the commission?
The one I had is whether we're okay with staked compost filter sock or whether you need hay bales for that level of disruption. That's pretty flat. flat site, so Chuck, maybe you want to be on that.
What size is the compost filter sock?
12-inch. What do you like to see, 18?
No, I think we've used 12 before. This is...
I don't have a point of view on it, just...
So the idea is not to compact that area, right? So you won't be driving in there anyways.
Right.
So he should be pretty far away.
Okay. Go ahead.
Any comments from the community? Hearing none.
I move we issue a negative determination with conditions.
Second.
All those in favor?
Do you want to go over your conditions? The trench extends from the front to the back of the lot. 12-inch mulch sock.
Snow storage will be east and west of dumpsters. And what's the commission's sense about guardrail?
I thought it was a good idea. Not guardrail, but okay, some kind of a
demarcation.
Yeah, I thought it was like a wooden fence, or
that really wouldn't do any harm to the drainage.
No, and it would allow.
It could probably be installed in the drainage if it.
That's what's going to be my suggestion. Right at the edge of pavement, we can put the wooden guardrail. It can go in where the trench is going. It's not going to affect it at all.
No,
there's no pipe in there or anything.
Jack.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And it being a little after 7:10, we have a request for determination of applicability 2017-10, 288 to 292 Grove Street, Lot 37, Lot 4, Meadowbrook Golf Club.
Sullivan, and I'm here with Bob Morelli of Meadowbrook Golf Course.
What plan?
If you pull up the demolition plan first. So, this is the clubhouse for the Meadowbrook Golf Course. The golf club has decided that they are going to look to demolish the existing clubhouse and build a new one on site. As such, I prepared a survey and I had Norse Environmental delineate the wetlands, which are over here, which are to the left of the existing entrance to the site. The 100-foot buffer from the wetlands falls right here. So the entire new clubhouse, that's the existing, but the new clubhouse is going roughly in the same location, will be outside of the 100-foot buffer zone. So what we look to do with this is, right now the existing entrance is pretty wide. There's parking that takes place in here. So we're looking to fine tune the curb cut locations for this site. And in doing so, we wanted to reduce the size of the curb cut. So in this case, this hatched area here is existing pavement that will be removed. So we're removing almost 2,000 square feet of pavement that right now is within the buffer zone. We met with Chuck and town staff early on in this project to talk about design options. One idea originally was to try to produce a large-scale rain garden in this area. The problem with that is a large amount of the pavement that's being removed is within the town right-of-way, and the town engineer wasn't too comfortable with us constructing a rain garden within the right-of-way, just in case in the future they ever want to do a sidewalk or any types of improvements within the right-of-way. So within the town right-of-way, this will be grass area, and another reason for that is there's a lot of existing infrastructure in there, like water gates, there's drain lines, so we want to leave access to manholes and gates for the town. We didn't want to really can't plant it, so we were gonna look to grass it.
Jack, at the DRT meeting, I'm not sure you picked up this, Ryan's out, and we asked that you made that into a swale and didn't plant it.
That's right.
So we wanted you to extend the rain garden, and if the town needed to do whatever they needed to do in the future, we're only talking about grass and a little bit of topsoil.
Right, up there.
So, sorry, explain that again.
That's that where that area is.
So we've got the next plan right into that.
For the site plan, but Chuck's right, and I need to add some drainage, but I can get into that. But Chuck is correct. We did have a DRT meeting, and it came up that they'd like to see, Chuck would like to see some sort of swale through there, because can we go to the site plan slide?
Sure. The real reason is we're not capturing everything, and it would be better, we want to try to capture as much water off this site as we possibly can to extend this area right here below the rain garden into a swale and have it incorporated into that rain garden some way, maybe a forebay, maybe not, maybe just an open, unplanted portion of the rain garden. You know, it's a very steep site, and it's by having that lower on the site, it will collect more water because it runs down and it runs towards the rain garden at the same time. So the longer that is, the more extended that is, the more water it will capture.
So just so I understand, you want to extend it off of here so that it's capturing, as water's draining this way, and sending it into the rain garden?
So what came up at the DRT meeting, which is a good suggestion, right now if you've been out to the club, it's steep going up the hill, okay? That grade's gonna be cut down. They're gonna have a drop-off area in here. We're gonna cut that grade by about 3 feet in height. Even with that said, there's been some concerns over the years. Right now, water just sheet flows down onto Grove Street. I believe some of the abutters have had concerns with drainage. The town's aware of this. So what they've asked me to do, which I'm willing to do, is in this area right here, I'm gonna look to put in a trench drain to collect water coming off of this hill. We're bringing this grade down, so the only area where water will now sheet flow out to Grove Street is this small area instead of all from the up gradient side of the club. And then I'm gonna drop that into the rain garden as well. And then I think what the idea would be to be put crushed stone in this area, like a swale, so that as this rain garden overflows, it would run out this channel and then get towards the wetland area. So that, we have a meeting Monday night with CPDC. A lot of this will be discussed. So tonight's hearing, we're gonna continue anyways. So there are some changes I have to make, but I wanted to bring you guys up to speed on where we are with this project. And just to give you an idea of the site drainage, since there might be some abutters here tonight, we're looking to do a low impact drainage design. We're gonna put in a 20,000 gallon rainwater harvesting tank. So that'll collect the entire roof runoff area of the club, okay? So in a 2-inch storm event, we have enough capacity in this tank to store the first 2 inches of rainfall off of the roof. For larger storm events, there'll be an overflow from the rainwater harvesting tank out to the rain garden. I showed I did a drainage study for the 210 and 100 year storm where we have a good size reduction in peak rates of runoff and stormwater volume of runoff. And by taking this pavement area out too, that's closer to the buff area, it's a win-win. The town seemed to like the idea of the rainwater harvesting tank. I've wanted to use rainwater harvesting systems in the past, but they don't work unless you have a large enough roof area. And in this case, the roof area is gonna be about 7,000 square feet, so it works well. And they provided a landscape plan as part of the design with CPDC, and the landscaping will be irrigated with the rainwater harvesting tank.
So Jack, is it 20,000 gallon?
10,000, it says on the plan.
Did I say 10?
On the plan.
It might be 10. For some reason, I'm at 20,000 in my head. Thank you.
So that works in the summer. What do you do with the excess water? I mean, you're not irrigating during the fall. maybe late fall into winter. So what happens with the overflow?
In the winter, it would overflow out to the rain garden.
Okay.
So during the spring, summer, and fall, it would be used.
Mm-hmm.
The clubs really, they're very active up until like Columbus Day weekend in October. So there would be a need for irrigation, but you're right. But over the winter months, typically it falls as snow. I mean, you get melt and other things, but you're not getting your large-scale rain events like you typically do in the spring. You can, but you typically don't see a 100-year storm event in the winter unless you get a big, you do get snow melt, but that's why you need to have an overflow from this system.
Questions, Chuck?
Yeah, I thought, you know, I'm not sure you kind of looked at that rain garden again, but my recollection was we had the swale below it and we had an extended rain garden above it. My next question is, I don't see the tree row at the base of the rain garden, so not really sure how it's getting from the overflow in, or you're directing it down the steep hill to the wetland. So
I need to show some more detail on
that. Is there going to, yeah, what's that going to look like? And then there's two trees out there.
That will be saved.
You're saving both those trees?
Correct.
Okay.
So the area that this rain garden going now, I should have brought some pictures in, but it's grassed. But there's two trees out there. One's like a 24-inch, one's a 20-inch tree. Those will be saved. We're not cutting any trees as part of this project, except there will be a couple trees around the existing clubhouse, but no trees within 100 feet of the wetlands.
So specifically within 100 feet, you're just changing the grade of the grass.
Right.
And
so
the drainage.
That's why this was an RDA and not a notice of intent, because it's really for the work within 100 feet, we're basically removing 2,000 square feet of pavement. We're creating a rain garden. We are going to add some drainage in that area, but the building and all the other infrastructure is outside the 100 feet. Even on my demolition plan, we tried to show like staging where equipment would be stored, where construction trailers will go, porta-potties, all materials will be outside of the 100-foot buffer.
And there's less water running into the 100-foot than there is today.
Correct, in the post-development.
And less going to Grove Street.
Less going to Grove Street once I add the trench grade, which I will add.
I have a question on the 10,000-gallon tank. It's more just curiosity, but you know that there's a hurricane in Florida and it's coming up the coast and we're going to get a big rainstorm in a week. Can they pump it out ahead of time?
They could. I don't know if they would do that, though. I mean, you could. It would be like a septic tank. You can come and you can take anything out of a tank that you want to, but I don't know.
I mean, couldn't they just turn the sprinklers on? And
they could. Just draw it down. And there's also, with these rainwater harvesting tanks, in the case where it's a very dry period and let's say the tank runs empty, they can set up the plumbing to add water to draw water as well to the tank. So there's a mechanism in place that it can call for water from the building if it needs it to fill.
Okay.
Jack, what roughly is the depth to water across in the vicinity of the holding tank? I'm just curious.
Like uplift pressure?
Yeah.
I haven't done soil testing. I talked to the town engineering department today. One of the conditions is that we do some test holes out here to see. The soil should be sand. The soil maps show it is sand and gravel. But I do have to get a determination where the water table is to make sure I'm above it. But I don't have that information.
Okay.
Right now.
Will that be 10 before our next meeting?
Yes.
I'll
let you know as well, so you can come out as well.
I was just asking about
for detail,
or you want more?
I
want
to
see. Yeah, that's.
Plan.
He was just showing a different. This is it. No.
You don't have
that's the ones
with
the details.
The tank on
up top construction.
On the construction details, do you?
I didn't hear what you said.
You don't have the tank on the construction details, do you?
I do not.
Okay. If if they aren't, just like, if they aren't, and so this thing fills up until it hits the overflow mark, and then it will run down to the rain garden. If they aren't using it for irrigation, I mean, this is similar to the, I mean, presumably you never want to just empty it out, and you're not using, you know, similar to what you said. If you're pumping into it, you know, you're losing some of that storage capacity. Was that considered in the rain, that it's typically going to be half filled, or?
I'd have to look at my drainage report, but I think the way I looked at it is I think I did take credit for it. I'm confusing this, so I did a site in Lexington where I didn't take any credit for the rainwater harvesting, just saying, let's say it's full at all times.
Because I have a tough time imagining that it's going to be empty. You know, they're going to keep it at some level, if whether you're using it or pumping into it to grab from it.
It'll continuously be in use, so you know, if they've run the irrigation daily,
mm-hmm.
as most people do in the summer, spring, summer, fall time, there'll be a constant flux in the water level. But I wouldn't anticipate it to be totally full all the time. Except like Rebecca said, maybe in the winter, if it's warm out and there's a heavy rainstorm, you know, it could fill up, and then it's not going to be in use, so it would just go out to the rain garden.
Jack?
I'll look at my drainage calculations on that and see, even if it was full, how the site would be. Okay, I still think by removing the pavement and the other improvements we've made, I think we'd still be below present drainage rates.
Can I just ask a quick question about sort of the second driveway? I know it's outside of the 100 foot. It's just another area of pavement that's probably going to contribute to Grove Street.
It's draining back towards the building. I had to put in a leaching catch basin. So that's a service.
Leaching catch basin.
Yep,
okay.
So that's a service entrance. What Annika is talking about is right here for the public. We have a service entrance with a dumpster, and then there's some service doors here, but there'll be a catch basin here. We're about almost a foot lower at this door than Grove Street, so drainage will be coming back towards the site. And that, the two curb cuts, just so everyone knows, we have to go to the Board of Selectmen for that. You're only allowed one curb cut unless there's space greater than 125 feet. These are not spaced 125 feet. The town seems in support of it, but we do have to go to the Board of Selectmen for the curb cuts.
Gotcha.
Are the storm drains that are on the road on here anywhere?
They're on my drainage plan, they are. The GDU. So there's a catch basin here right now. So that's in the area where we're taking the pavement out. So we're showing a new basin to be placed at the new edge of travelway, and we'll convert this catch basin to a drain manhole. They don't allow catch basins to be in series. I'd rather just leave the catch basin, but the town doesn't want to see catch basin to catch basin. We're still, there's a 12-inch drain here now. There'll be a 12-inch drain. We're just putting a catch basin on that drain line.
Is there anything further down Grove Street?
Not that I know of.
Not
I don't believe
so.
So it all
the
runs, it all runs. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And then this is piped across, and then there's a brook over there that
Runs
into.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the commission? Chuck?
Just like the last applicant, snow storage and guardrail to protect the rain garden and to prevent snow from going into it.
That's a good suggestion.
Any comments from the community? are you done, Chuck? No?
No, what did Jack say? I didn't hear that.
I said that's a good suggestion.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It's like, I remember you, yeah.
Nick Bonanno, 283 Grove Street.
Yeah.
Pretty much opposite the proposed rain garden. And I just have a few questions for clarification. On the storage tank, the rainwater storage tank, just for my edification, there's always water collected in there that that can be used locally around the clubhouse for watering, irrigation, that type of thing. And then at some point, there's an overflow where it triggers and starts to go towards the rain garden. So do we know, I'm just curious, what is the fill level before it spills into the outflow pipe to get to the rain garden?
I can provide it, if I can. I can provide a detail on that. It's just a drainage pipe. So up the tank, might, let's say, is 4 to 5 feet deep. So the pipe might be a foot down from the top, and it'll go out. So there's no pump or float that needs to be triggered. It'll be by gravity.
Right.
When it reaches a certain level, it'll move out through that drain pipe by gravity.
So then the next question is, if the cover over that pipe to the rain garden is that shallow, I mean, is it like 2 feet deep or something, the cover over the pipe? What happens if it freezes? If there's water in there and it was to freeze, then what happens?
It won't freeze.
It won't freeze.
In a lot of communities on drain pipes, you only need about 2.5 feet of cover. I have it for ADS piping. It will not freeze, even though typically you think like frost line's 4 feet down. I believe I'll even have to check the town's regs. I don't think they require 4 feet of coverage on a drain pipe.
So that's just the natural
this, the
heat
ground
of the soil
insulates it.
Yeah, I see.
So even, excuse me, with several feet of cover at the storage tank, there's enough of a slope across the proposed paved area to empty?
Correct.
At the right spot on the
correct.
Okay. All right. And the size of the rain garden, I see on this drawing, it ends pretty much at the property line.
Correct.
And the discussion that took place earlier, it wasn't clear to me if the rain garden itself is extending out into the town right of way, or if that is going to be the rain garden, everything outside the property line is gravel or grass or something else.
To clarify that, the rain garden needs to go on the private property. There was talks of putting a crushed stone swale within this area here to direct water to the wetland area, which is fine.
So are there, I'm not too familiar with rain gardens, but are there restrictions that go with the approval, if that's the solution? Are there restrictions or conditions for the property owner to maintain it, weed it, you know, make sure it's functioning correctly? Is there ongoing testing, or what are all the steps that take place?
I can answer that, Chuck.
Sure.
I provide an operation and maintenance plan, and that report has to be submitted annually to the engineering department in the town. I'm sure the Conservation Commission's copied on it as well. But it talks about how often it needs to be inspected, inspection of the vegetation, looking for any sort of erosion. It's detailed. It gets filed with the commission, and that report then becomes the responsibility of the club to do the annual maintenance.
Yeah, and to add to that, so we sent a memo out today for your meeting, and I requested that, and I actually put one together too, and the only difference from what Jack said was I asked for two reports, so that could be modified to one, or you can just accept two, so whichever that is. But it is quite detailed. You could get a copy of that if you wanted to.
Okay,
but
thank you.
It does talk about just about everything that can happen, from replacing the shrubs, the mulch, and sweeping out any debris that gets in there, you know, once a month.
Thank you. And the last question I have, snow removal. Currently, and Bob, correct me if I'm wrong, a lot of the snow removal or the plowing of the existing parking area and drive is pushed out into the street and then kind of off to the right. With the proposed curbing, that I don't know if that's really possible any longer. So is there... what is the management plan for snow removal?
Well, we'll just push it the other way.
You're going to push it uphill?
Yeah. We do now.
No, I've kind of seen the
well, they come
plow
down,
coming down.
They go back
time.
Up again, so now we'll just go down and start at the bottom.
All right, so the intent is not to, so the intent is not to push the snow from the club onto the town right of way to the, as you exit the club, it would be to the right. There will be no more snow piled up there.
There shouldn't be. The intent would be to push it from the street to pretty much where the 8th tee is.
Okay.
have a question on just the detail that's at the edge of Grove Street in front of the clubhouse. Is that the stone wall that's out there on
yes.
Grove Street?
Yes.
So the stone wall
There's a stone wall right along this property line.
What's that curved line that's out into the that one, yeah.
This is going to be new. We're adding vertical granite curbing into it. Right now, this is all open. Can you go to the existing conditions plan, Chuck? I'll show. So here's a stone retaining wall right at the property line.
Yep.
Right now, there's a pavement line, but there's no curbing or berm or anything.
Mm-hmm.
So when we met with the engineering department, they wanted to see us put in install vertical granite curbing to establish that gutter line.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, the club uses this to park,
mm-hmm.
so that's going to be eliminated as well. The employees use it to park, I should say.
I have an unrelated question to wetlands, only because I've almost hit somebody on Grove Street. Did they eliminate, there's a little steep area, a walkway to the left of the clubhouse now, and it is pretty steep, and the golfers come down that and get across Grove Street. Are they changing that layout?
I don't know.
No? Okay. Guess I'll have to go slowly.
Just put a sign up, beware of
going slowly.
Yeah, really.
There's signs up there. There's four signs all the way up Grove Street with two cart path marked out on Grove Street.
Yeah.
Because of cars coming down.
Yeah. I find that one dangerous. Because he's, I don't know, one of the golfers just didn't really look. It just came barreling down that hill.
He had a bad drive.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, do I hear a motion to?
Make a motion.
We're going to continue.
It would be a good idea. I know you said you probably would, but to get the tank detail onto the construction detail. I make a motion to continue.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
When's the next hearing?
2 weeks.
Is it in 2 weeks?
Yeah.
23rd, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yep.
The next item on the agenda is a notice of intent. 270-06870 Border Road, map 6, lot 4, Hanson. Continuation, it's now open and being conducted. We're currently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing is conducted the following manner. Applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions, which should be directed to the chair. And when you do, please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. And I believe most of you folks have signed in. Sign-in sheet. Okay.
Chair,
is this the first meeting?
No,
this is continuation.
Sorry about that. I've got my little pointer. If you don't mind, I'll give you an update of where we're at. There's a dozen of items to go over. So at last we met on July 26th. We had submitted, or had just about submitted data forms, I think Chuck got on that day. So they were submitted from Steve Erickson. We did ID all the trees in the buffer zone. If you recall, there was a catalpa tree just off the land here that's shown on the right there on the drawing, as well as that 6-inch tree. that we saw out in the field. There are a total of 10 trees now to be removed in the buffer zone, and all the other trees that are not being removed are shown as well. There. We added a construction entrance at Chuck's suggestion, a stone pad, and right over here. We made a pretty substantial change to the plan. Yeah, if you can zoom. We added a rain garden, again at Chuck's suggestion, and we're sending the flow from the roof to the rain garden out front. It's a small 75 square foot rain garden, and there's the detail for it. There it is. So you see the downspout comes down, and it's directed to a dry well, which will fill up and spill out into the rain garden. So that it will it'll work just a few inches of flow, and then that is planted with these plants here, and the schedule is over here. And I think we have arrowwood. It's hard to read that one. Arrowwood, northern arrowwood, common St. John's wort, and a lotus bird for trefoil. So those are plants that are in the DEP manual. A total of 7 of those. We're going to get to back to that. Some of the erosion control on the perimeter was extended and clarified. Yeah, there you go. Some of the stuff around the loam pile was extended during construction. Again, at Chuck's suggestion. The board and Chuck's suggestion was to add an infiltration trench along the driveway, and that was added to the plan. We didn't talk about this at the last meeting, so it's not a change, but there are 8 construction signs, the typical ones that the town of Reading likes, and there's a detail for that over here on the plan, up to the upper right. That was on the plan. It was not a change, but we did not talk about that. There was a fee paid for work in this zone right here for this walkway and the staircase. Total is $436.25. It was calculated, a letter was submitted, and the fee was paid for that. We talked about that a little bit at the last meeting, too. I'm going to skip the next one. We moved wetland flag 10A. There, down about 5 feet southwest, at the suggestion of the board. There was a buffer zone notation for the 50 foot that said 100 feet or something like that. That was a mistake, if you recall, on the plan. That was removed. And there's a note that basically says right there, the entire site is within the 100 foot buffer zone. The loam pile that we proposed to excavate to 104. We added a note right here that says and we talked about this, to be done right after the trees have been cut, because otherwise the route that they would take would be cut off by the building. So that's just common sense, but it's obvious. Which brings me to the tree removal. Like I said, there are 11 trees to be cut within your zone. And we're proposing 7 in the rain garden, 7 bushes. And so that I would suggest, and I know you're going to put this in a condition, but my suggestion would be the total bushes of 16 on the property, including the 7 in the rain garden, which would equate to 8 trees, and then 3 trees all to be replanted. But that's up to discussion. That was just my suggestion. And lastly, very important, I know that some of you walked on Tuesday with Steve Erickson and Maureen in this area, especially right here, to verify the wetland flags, and I'm told that they were verified. I was not at the site walk, but some of you were. That is my update.
Yeah, we Dave Panette, myself, and Chuck Tarani met with Norse Environmental, Steve Erickson and Maureen. And we did, the reason we had asked to take a look at the wetland line, in particular to the east, on the east side adjacent to the proposal, was that there is a lot of jewel weed, Impatiens capensis, but there are also some upland plants in there, but we thought it was pretty spongy the last time, our first site walk. Maureen dug several holes with an auger as well as a tile spade, and the area is really disturbed. There's a lot of rock, probably refuse or debris from when they constructed I-93 that could be, or I guess it was a greenhouse in a forested tree farm at some point. So it was really quite disturbed, but the soils did appear very dry. They didn't have the chroma that would be necessary to think that they would be hydric. And there were also root systems down below, and there was no presence of water. So given that, we concurred with Norse that those were upland areas. Now there were some areas on the west side of the stream that there may be some wetland, but at this point what we're going to decide is not to confirm those wetland flags.
Oh, particular flags, okay.
Yeah.
We're not proposing any work over there whatsoever.
That's true, but you know, when
this is
15 whenever feet. That the house is, yeah, the 15 house
needed 24 feet.
20, yes. The house has just been sold, and when that individual wants to do work, they will have to come before us. So hopefully that has been conveyed to the new owners.
And that's fine with us. That makes sense.
Any questions from the commission members?
Anika. So it looks like on the new plan we received this time, I'm just looking for the figure note for it. I don't see it, so...
do you want to look at this one?
Between the 25-foot no disturb and the 35-foot no build, is there a fence proposed?
Right. These posts right here?
Lines with dots on them. Yep.
So 1, 2, 3, 4.
No, that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is a line type. Just passed between the 25 and the 35.
It
looks
here.
Like a fence line. Is that a fence?
No. This line, it's just this line right along here?
Not the 25 foot.
Okay.
But between the 25 and the 35.
Oh, this is a contour line. That's right there, that one?
No.
I think that's the erosion.
No, it's a line with a dot, and a line with a dot, and a line with a dot.
There's an erosion control line.
I'm going to
enlarge
this. Right. So one of the lines is an...
Oh, that's erosion control. That's not a fence.
That's
an erosion control
line. One of the lines
fence.
Is the 35 foot. Correct.
That's your line type for erosion control?
Yes.
Okay.
That's right all the way around here.
There's a lot of tiny
all
detail
way
on this scale. So
it comes back and around. Yeah, it is an erosion control line.
Okay. Did you have some specific plans or construction or, you know... What are your methods for removing the loam pile?
I didn't specify them, but I would imagine they would put a truck here and an excavator here and then just fill up the truck and out it would go before, the key would be before the building is built.
Okay, and at what point, excavated to what
final
elevation?
104. So 104 is... Just so you know, the contour, this darker line right there.
Yeah,
that's
there's a kind of
a...
I know, it's tiny, though. I can't barely
take
read
a look at this
I'm
one.
I'm trying.
So it's about 3 to 4 feet above the ground.
Right here.
And what's the why 104?
It's just an arbitrary number, I guess.
It's just picked randomly?
We're not proposing it to be a wetland area, but we don't want it to be a big hill either. I think if we get down to 102, it could get wetland plants in it. So I chose 104 to make sure there wouldn't be, but it could be 103.
It's one way to do it.
If it gets down to 102, I think it's going to get spongy like this area was here.
All right.
That whole back area we talked about when we were out there, not just where the pile is, but where we looked at the flags, and it seemed like there was really no rhyme or rhythm to where water would extend out to. And one of the questions that we're going to bring up tonight and I'm bringing it up now is, with that pile being raised up a foot, we still have the same situation. We were thinking, or I was thinking, that maybe you would lower that and it would detain some of the water
and maybe help out that situation a little bit so things come around the property and then into the drainage swale. So right about at flag, I think it's WF9, that's when it becomes more even and everything's in the drainage swale. But before that, the water spreads out all over the property in that area.
Is that what this flag
is? No,
on the WF9B.
So I'm talking about here.
Yep.
It seems to spread out in this area here and just go all over. This side's a little bit higher. It's not so high over there. So how are you going to handle that and kind of contain, I guess, any future flooding that's going to head towards that proposed house?
Well, the house is at a higher elevation. It is a slab, if you remember me telling you that before. And you can see the contour line around the house, basically spreads around the house so that the house would be kind of raised up and it is a sort of island of itself. And this water would just flow into the brook like it always does. We're not proposing any work in here, obviously, in the 25-foot zone. So it would continue to look, I guess, like it looks now. And I don't see this, digging this out to a lower level, I don't see that as being detained. We're sending all of our water from the house this way. So all this runoff is sent to the rain garden and then ultimately to the wetland over here. We're not sending anything to the north, the northeast. And I've talked about it with Mr. Hansen, and we don't see a need to, for quote, a detention basin there. We don't even see where the flow would come from. This flow is going that way, this flow is going this way, right here.
So say it's at 104 feet, what?
Excuse me?
Say it's at 104 feet, is there a planting plan? What's it supposed to look like when
it's
all
done? It'd just be loamed and seeded.
Seated.
Well, we could leave it alone.
Seeded with grass?
We took the cues from the board that they wanted it, and Chuck, that made sense to remove it. It's just an old loam pile that kind of,
well, so
it doesn't look aesthetically good, it doesn't do anybody anything.
So after you remove it, seeded with grass, seeded with wetland plants, or you mentioned upland.
What is going to be in either the 25 or the 35 foot? So you're going to have to do something native vegetation, and then maybe that would be a good area for those three trees or something.
Right. This is a perfect area for the three trees because it's in the wetland, and everybody on there wants a buffer to the highway right there. So certainly those would be perfect place for large growing trees right there.
Did you consider any of the runoff coming from the side, that slope to the highway, and runoff coming off that slope?
I think
it's pretty steep.
It gathers up and goes this way. I think it just kind of goes around it. That's
well, there's
the
a culvert there that's giving you most of your problem.
Right here.
Yeah.
And this one too, on Border Road.
My other question, I apologize, is probably in the package. I just have the latest update. Is this whole property in a floodplain?
No.
Some of it, any of it?
None of it. I can double check. It's in our package. None of it's in the floodplain.
It's not okay.
No. I got it right here.
Is part of this project to refurbish that manhole, the drain, the catch basin along Border Road?
This one down here?
Yeah.
No, somebody had mentioned that earlier, that the head wall, I think Mr. Curtis mentioned, or maybe Mr. Pinnett, that the town should possibly do something or put some boulders or some outbuilding.
I just mentioned that to the Hansons the other day. I don't know whether that culvert, that invert at the culvert right there at the roadway is on town property or their property, but something really needs to be done to it.
Like, yeah, the actual invert is actually on the town property. It's right there.
Because it was, when we went out in the spring, that was clogged.
Right.
And I reached down and pulled some stuff out of there to allow water to flow, but it's in bad shape.
You remember, and I wasn't here at the meeting, where Mr. Hansen came in and showed you pictures, I think, of the DPW there cleaning up this. Certainly they need to do that.
So I don't know, you know, that would... It certainly should be part of the plan moving forward to correct that, whether it's on private property or public property, because that's a key part of the whole system working.
We talked about this a little bit last week, but so there is a portion of the driveway, a walkway, and steps that are within the 35?
Right here, yeah. And that's what the additional fee was paid for.
So this would be a variance, correct?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, can we talk about that? Are you asking?
Yeah, no, let's...
So the variance is specifically for, and I'm reading your regulations, including these to protect the integrity of ZNV, Zone of Natural Vegetation, including the root system and canopy. No new foundations, including footings, frost walls, or other in-ground structures, shall be permitted within 10 feet of the ZNV. So we're not doing that. We're just putting a sidewalk in. So there's no foundation, footings, or underground structures.
Is pavement not an in-ground structure? We're paving the area, we're preventing any root growth in that area, correct?
Right, it's not in the ground.
Pavement?
We're paying the fee for it because it is a, you said last time you consider it a structure.
Oops.
But it's not in the ground structure, it's on the ground structure.
So that would be inconsistent with what we've done before. So we've asked everyone else that's come through this commission to do the variance.
We have applications going on right now that are doing that.
Send you guys the information, but I didn't know you had a question on it.
Yeah, that's. I looked it up and I said, "Boy, I don't see why we need a variance. We're not digging anything down. We're not putting a footing or a foundation or."
So
we see structure
as the
Webster's Dictionary. I know we don't have it called out in our regulations, and maybe we should, but really, if you follow that, anything's a structure.
But it specifically says frost walls, footings, or other in-ground structures.
So are you saying the pathway is going to be slab on top of grade?
Yeah, they're just asphalt walkways.
The pavement's probably going to be flush with grade.
Right.
So right, so it's going to be in ground.
Okay, let's go. I don't want to debate.
I'm just
I don't
want
to sound
right.
Like I'm debating, but look, this says no new foundations. That's the subject matter. Including footings, frost walls, or other in ground. So that's where I'm reading it, just so you know. I'm not...
I understand, but we are
going to
be asking
for a
variance.
If we need to file a variance, we'll file a variance. I just...
Okay.
Just to go forward, I have some questions about what's going to be planted within that 25-foot zone. I don't see anything proposed at this point between the wetland flags, the BVW, and the 25-foot. Does that mean that no plantings are proposed at this point?
Correct. I'm under the impression you don't want any work to be done in there, including plantings.
Plantings, I believe, are the one thing we do permit. As a matter of fact, that's the purpose of the 25-foot, is to create a vegetated buffer.
Okay.
It's been the practice to populate that area with native vegetation. Otherwise, if you don't put something in, all of a sudden you get invasive plants that not only stop native, you get invasives that stop natives from growing, but also don't support the native bugs and birds and all that other stuff.
So, like a high bush blueberry, is that what you're talking about?
Things of that nature.
Variety.
That's, yeah.
Chuck has a list.
Okay.
Are you asking to see a planting plan of the whole site?
I'd like to know if he's asking us to approve this, I want to know what it's going to look like when it's done.
Well, that's what it sounds like you're asking for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to know what it's going to look like when it's done,
so
that
I
know...
Quest, if there's another plan, if we could, I like how you saved paper with the way that you put this plan together, but when you get them on 8.5 by 11, it's impossible to read. So if you can make a couple different plan sets, it'd be great. You know, 8.5 by 11, maybe just to the site, and then the next one of the details, and the other one of the planting details.
Got it.
Related to that, so we're talking about doing a variance for the walkway and the stairs. Is consideration for that, are there any particularly, other than the dreaded catalpa tree, are there any invasives that we think should be addressed as part of this plan as an offset for the variance?
Are you asking me what I would suggest?
Sure.
Because I think
the commission could offer ideas of what.
I think they're already removing that dirt pile, and that's not very helpful.
Yeah.
That pile of dirt, basically, in my opinion, was put on top of a wetland. But if we saw it planted somehow, 25-foot native, and then grass and between the 10, between the 25 and the 35-foot, that would be, mitigation.
Okay. So there's not, all right, so there isn't a big
stand. There's something going on that there, that's
yeah, no,
improved.
I
if it's not enough, does that improvement meet the size and scope of this project, in your opinion? If it doesn't, you certainly could say that and ask for more.
Size and scope of the aspects that are causing the variance, you can consider the project, but really the variance, that's what the mitigation is for.
One part of it is talking about mitigation now, but still there's that size and scope thing. Is this thing going to work in the future, or is there just so much disruption there? What's the balance?
Well, I mean, if you don't get the dirt pile out of there now, you never get it out of there, because once the house is there, you can't.
No, I think that's a great idea.
So, I just asked.
I just want to know what's under it.
Well,
Jimmy Hoffa.
That's actually a question I was wondering about. You know, if you get to that 104-foot and you find you're half digging out, a couple dozen tires, do you stop digging?
No.
Then he calls Chuck and says, now what do we do?
Should be said that when we were out there, I don't know if anyone agreed with me, but this soil was so rocky and stony, it seemed like it was a manufactured area that could have been the construction entrance to a portion of that highway being built. It was extremely tough to dig even 12 inches. So there could be something in that pile or under that pile. I'm not saying there's not maybe a big rock or something, but
I hope not for the sake of
it's a manufactured area.
Right.
So, I guess it's draining a bit, but it seemed like when we dug through it was dry, but the top was kind of, like cake and
cemented.
And,
that might be an artifact of how long it's been there.
Mm. But underneath was nice and dry.
Extremely dry. Oh.
Extremely brown and
dry.
Yellow.
Okay.
Happy fellow, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
Was the idea of removing that dirt pile to my thought was that they were going to put it back to a wetland area. But now I'm hearing it's going to be a little bit higher and a little bit drier.
I think that was my thought as well. I'm not opposed to having it up a little bit. It does seem funny. 704 is 2 feet above the house. So now anything that drains is going to be still draining. It seems like the 704, I know it's, you had to pick something.
104.
Yeah, sorry. 104 is, I know you had to pick something, but it seems like that's still, in essence, an elevated area relative to everything else that's out there. So I don't know if it does make sense to bring it down even just a couple feet to at least get down to the elevation of the house.
I think that makes sense. I'm going to talk to Steve Erickson. If we're going to continue tonight, which I think we're heading towards, I'll only talk to Steve and we'll come up with what he thinks and I think is best elevation.
Okay.
It was pretty arbitrary,
yeah.
So let's get the botanist involved.
It's tough when it's 12 feet high.
And I presume you're going to have conditions in so that if there are tires or deleterious material that during construction that you get notified and the Chuck goes out there.
Unexpected things can come up in this.
Just so you don't do what happens and you say you don't know what's under there. And Carlisle, the new librarian, just found Civil War ordnance live in a closet. And the bomb squad came in and blew it up, and it actually blew up.
Oh, really?
From 175 years ago.
Well,
hopefully there's no ordinance.
No,
no thanks.
So
Are you okay with the elevation instead of the depression for a wetland, or is that something you want Steve to investigate also?
I think we left it that we that Steve would take a look at it.
Yeah, so he's gonna look at both, not just
right.
Okay, elevation.
Yeah, I just want to make because it wasn't clear on this side. Okay. Is there any way I could be part of that conversation too?
Sure. You could do a conference call.
You can do a conference call. Yeah, that's. I think Steve usually comes to Reading for lunch, anyways.
Okay. No worries.
I see. You know, if you could choose to design an elevation for that back pile, you know, you could add some wetlands along the back property line, and that would be. You know, that could be additional mitigation, is increasing the area of wetland, you know. So, I mean, sit down with Steve, and I'm sure you guys can come up with something that fits.
I think
that
anybody
would
want to have some kind of buffer. So any tree that grows up 20 feet that is a wetland tree that creates some screening.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not talking about pines. I'm talking about, you know, wetland species that grow and kind of vine on things and to create a good buffer. Sure, we could look at that. It may be facultative wet instead of obligate, but something
mm-hmm.
like that.
Any questions from the community?
I move we continue.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
And that's again August 23rd, if I heard?
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
My eyesight's not that bad yet.
We have a continuance of notice of intent 270-0683, parcel 0, Haverhill Street, map 57, lot 17, Gillis. And the public hearing is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant, the hearing is conducted. The applicant presenting the proposal, commission will receive reports from administrator, technical advisor, and other town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. And when you do, please give your name and address before your comments or questions are presented. At this time, I'd like to introduce the members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my right.
And I'm, let the record show, I'm going to recuse myself from this discussion. So
do you want to give a reason, or just recuse?
Because I live right around the corner, and
that's fine.
I think even any discussion could be perceived as a conflict in either direction.
Okay. Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
David Panette.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tirani, Conservation Administrator.
Hey. Good evening. My name is Richard Harrington from Stamps Here at Canary, and I'm replacing Jimmy.
John Gillis, the applicant. My wife.
Caitlin.
We had the continuance, that we didn't have a quorum at the last meeting, so we had a chance to speak with staff again and made some additional revisions to the plan. So I'll be talking about basically two steps of revisions since the meeting that was in front of you prior. The plan has been revised to provide additional mitigation. It's also providing two alternatives for the replication areas associated with the Finger Lake projection that we're proposing at this location here. That area is doubled in proposed replication area. We have the proposed leaflet area that we're reestablishing it as an active wetland species with plants and native plantings there. That's an alternative number one, which is double the size of the proposed Finger Lake projection. The reason for the Finger Lake projection to be just not to remain but not be counted in this bylaw is to allow the 25-foot no disturb zone along the wetland line at this location, ignoring the Finger Lake projection, then a 35-foot buffer zone for the house to be outside the 35 with that. The second alternative, we had the wetlands delineated from the head wall along the road, and then back along the side property line by David Crossman of BNC Associates. We have a second alternative wetland fill where there's a small area in the front corner along the road where it drops down elevation from the edge of the property, and then an area in the back here. Again, what we're proposing to do is a small lowering of the grade here to the 74 contour, pulling it back, and then pulling back the 75 contour here. That will allow it to be a little bit lower to allow the native plantings and wetlands to achieve better results. We have a list at the top of the sheet that's not shown of additional wetland shrubs and plantings, which is up with the replication notes, where 5 or 6 shrub planting lists. 16 shrubs will be planted in that replication area. There'll be a minimum 10 feet on center, and no four that the there'll be New England wet mix provided by wetlands, New England wetland plants for that replication area. In addition to that location, what we did is I did talk to Barbara Melanson, the abutter. She did call our office a couple times, and we reviewed the plan and talked about the elevations of what's out there today. The head wall itself, where the invert is, it's elevation 72, where the pipe goes underneath the road. It's a 2-foot diameter pipe. So the top of that pipe is 74. The 74 contour is running basically right along, right this location. The top corner of our driveway is at 76 at this location, 76.1. She has a garage under at this location, so it's a little bit higher than that corner. The entire pavement from this, her driveway and also our neighbor's driveway, pitch down onto our property and then make their way across and then down and outside the pipe, down gradient. So we're not impeding that aspects at all of their current sheet flow coming onto our property. It's not a concern for us. Remove the leaf litter. We'll lower that elevation a little bit by removing what's ever piled up in that area. That will still drain in this direction down towards the existing ditch, which comes from the back of the property, meanders through, and then down to this location here. So you have a 73 contour, and then a 74 that takes itself around, and then 75. What we've also added to the plan in regards to the building itself is we have changed the back patio area, we reconfigured it, and we've added porous pavers so that the water, any water that falls in the earth, there'll be stone storage beneath it for that proposed area. That's, and we moved it to be outside the 35-foot buffer zone. We adjusted the grading in the back here to 3-to-1, so there's no physical barrier at that location. We have proposed markers along the 25-foot zone line, which would be granite markers with like a 6-inch reveal at a minimum, so that they'll be visible from the street. We've also added a rain garden at this location at the corner. Prior to that, we're gonna have a 1,000-gallon rain harvesting collection tank, and there'll be gutters and downspouts that'll drain and collect all the piping from both sides of the home into that rain garden. That tank that will overflow the rain garden, there's a little overflow lip here that will then allow the water to come down and make its way back down to the head wall. We, at the bottom of the plan, a majority of the storm water events are an inch or less in this area of New England. So we provided a 1-inch storage for the tank from the roof area, and then there's also a 1-inch storage for any runoff should the tank be full. There's at least more than 1 inch of storage in that rain garden at that location. That will allow for the plant community there'll be plantings in there also. There'll be a mulch bed to allow it to infiltrate, and then at certain times of year, it does have the overflow and make its way down to the head wall. In addition, we have the 6 or 7 notes that we have updated on the right side of the plan. We're proposing the trees in the front with a combination of 2 different styles, and then we've also have the shrubs along the edge of the wetlands and the post and rail fence. We added a couple steps just to drop down from the slab down to the patio area, and we minimized the grading at this location between the 25-foot to 35 at the closest corner of the house. So to overview, we originally had the invasive management plan to remove all the invasives and complement them with native plantings. The trees that we're removing were meeting the policies of the town as far as replacement as a combination of trees and shrubs. And we also have additional notes that allow for flexibility of where those get planted and where the applicant can work with staff if there's a better desired type of shrub or location that works better for this lot. As you recall also, there's additional utility boxes, et cetera, at the front corner along our frontage, which we're not touching at all. We're putting a little bit of a berm at that location so that the shrubs will be elevated a little bit along that corner lot. And the stepping stones and the driveway remains the same. There's the frontage, parking for 1 car and then 1 car inside the garage. And I believe that gives a good overview of what we've done. If there's any questions or I can elaborate any further.
We had a site visit on Tuesday morning and we followed the line of the wetland. Just so that you know, your wetland flag 58 is actually, should be 57 on the plan.
Okay.
Do you see it? Where it juts out?
There's 258s on the plan. That's what
right.
The problem was.
Was the flag in the right location?
It's that one there.
Yes. And we did see that it pretty much followed the topography.
Okay.
And I don't think we had any issues with the location of the flags and the wetland vegetation. I mean, there was significant wetland vegetation on the wetland side of those flags. We looked at the culvert, and it looked pretty clear. Maybe 1 or 2 inches of, mud on the bottom,
yes.
But most of it looked pretty open. We did find some trash concrete, at B and C 53 flag.
Okay.
And that we would ask that you remove that.
Certainly.
Any other comments from you, Dave?
The tree that was across the water course.
Well, we're going to, right. Yeah, we're going to ask for the, I don't know.
Just
if you finished, I didn't mean to interrupt.
There was some sticks, and there was one actual tree, about a 6-inch tree that had fallen a long time ago that's across the water course. But that just be removed.
Certainly, they can cut that up and get out of the stream bed.
Yeah.
There's already a note to add. There's a bunch of logs also from fallen trees that typically have the note to clean those up.
Yeah.
We can add that to it.
So speaking of that, I still feel like that periodically checking the stream to make sure there's no sticks in it would be a good idea,
mm-hmm.
and the front of the culvert,
mm-hmm.
just to make sure. I mean, there was nothing there that would really obstruct it, and it was clear that everything was heading down the stream. But there was that 1 6 to 7 inch DBH tree that was rotted, and it basically buried itself in the stream. And that was definitely an obstruction.
Mm-hmm.
So something like that probably wouldn't happen again. You know, you'd find it right away. But what we'd like you to do is if there's a sizable tree, just go 1 foot off the bank on either side, cut it out with a chainsaw, a regular saw, and just remove what's in the stream, leave the rest. But that'll be in
circular,
yeah.
What do you propose to plant in your rain garden? I don't see any plantings in there.
Rebecca, if you look at the notes,
right.
And I've got the big plan.
So, witch hazel, doja dogwood.
Yeah. Okay.
For the
right.
Both the rain garden and the porous paver, do you put any sort of geotextile or a filter fabric down between that and the native soil before you place each of the coarse, well, whether it's the soil mix or the rain garden or the porous paver? The gravel, really?
There is on the patio paver, and
okay.
The detail is a fabric on there, I believe.
Yeah.
I don't know,
pea gravel.
Pea gravel.
No, it's just a combination of crushed stone, pea gravel, Bankman gravel. And no, we try not to use, just to get down to native materials, and then we try not to use a filter fabric, just so it doesn't clog.
The filter fabric typically will help prevent it from clogging. The other direction, the native material going up into that gravel stone.
Okay.
Something to think about. It'll extend the life of that a little bit more. And then I don't know if is that typically standard in the. I mean, I care less about the porous section, more about the rain garden. Is that a tip? I know we typically see filter fabric with the rain gardens. I don't know how much impact it has there because it's a soil mix anyways. I just know that's a standard detail we've seen.
The filter fabric with rain gardens?
Yeah.
I have to, just trying to think of all the ones at Redding Woods that I've looked at. I actually do believe they all have filter fabric.
I think they do.
Yeah. So I guess we're just asking if you could add that.
I think it's probably a good idea to add it. I think it's
good.
On your wetland replication notes, just so that you're consistent as this gets recorded. Rhododendron, mm-hmm. It's you need an I between the V and an S. In Vaccinium corymbosum, you need a Y in there.
That's when you know you're doing a good job, when you're getting spelling errors.
Sorry, but
that was from me. Copied it verbatim. Didn't want to hear it. The opposite direction.
Sorry.
I have a question about can you speak to let's say that this plan goes ahead, generally speaking, as shown tonight. What would be the impact of a 2 or 5 or 10 year storm? What would that look like in terms of rain garden overflow, flooding around this house, and filling up that culvert? Because right now you're planning for the 1 inch storm, and I understand it's common, but the 2, 5, and 10 do also happen. So I'm just wondering if you've considered those other events and what might be the impact on this design.
So the 2 year storm event is 3.1 inches of rain, so over a 24 hour period. So with the close proximity to the wetlands in the limited space that we do have, we probably couldn't meet the storage requirements for the 3 inch storm event. We do have some recharge in the bottom, so the water will go in the ground, but it is in close contact with the stream. You also have water flowing through that might also take up some space there also. So with a single family house of this nature, is typically exempt from the stormwater management policies. What we think we did was we mitigated to the best of our possible ability with the trenches along the sides also of the buildings. And then we wouldn't be impeding any of the flow that's currently coming through the property for the larger storm events.
Right, I guess I'm wondering if, just based on your experience knowing storms and knowing the topography and how this drainage is set up, would a 10-year storm essentially fill in the entire wetland area? If that's a 7-inch storm in 24 hours?
Well,
I think it's difficult to know that's going to be without knowing the inflow from, a big portion of the storage on this site is inflow from the
neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's a serious.
Where's the drainage area?
Yeah.
So on the opposite side of the street is too.
So in taking care of ourselves on our own property, we can meet all the storm requirements and have the storage. It's just the additional flows that are coming through the property today.
I'm just trying to be realistic.
Oh sure. Well, what I can say is this: with this 24 inch pipe, like you said, it is very clean. In other instances, we've seen many of these where you'll see staining along the top where you know that it's been submerged for a long period of time in the spring. But I didn't see that there. So with that being open and where elevations are up at 75 in this location and 77 or higher for the slab, we wouldn't have any flooding problems around the house, number one. And we, with the additional storage, we'd be meeting what's out there today.
Okay. Can I ask the neighbors, Madam Chair, if anybody's seen that culvert overtopped in the last recent history, if you'll entertain that.
We've been there for 48 years.
Excuse me, your name is?
Phyllis Maxwell, 93 Batchelder Road. My property runs right along the back of the driveway. And when we have even an inch of rain, the water can sit in the land right behind where their house will be for a day or more.
So it's stagnant.
Right.
But have you seen the road overtopped?
I've never seen it go over the top, but I've seen it come right to the top.
Okay.
Top of the culvert?
Of the culvert, yes.
So there's
a lot of water that flows in from the properties in the back. And we often have storms that, you know, are more than 1 inch. And I wonder about in the spring when we have frozen ground, water flowing, and rain coming down at the same time, what's going to happen back there with all this other added to it.
Yeah, it seems like they did check the elevations and everything's heading down to the culvert. When I looked down the culvert, you know, remember I said, geez, I thought I might see some light coming from the other side, although it doesn't daylight at the other side of the road. It's further down.
I don't know if it goes
left or right, and that could have been the reason, but I mean, I could bring that up to the engineering department and ask them if they are aware of any flooding on this piece of property and ask them to check the culvert for any blockage. Because that, I don't know if that's ever happened. Do you remember anyone making phone calls like that or the DPW being out there?
On the downstream end of the culvert.
It hasn't been the
blockage on the downstream end of the culvert.
Or even in it. We have calls all the time from people saying that things just get jammed in there and they have to jet it out.
It hasn't been the DPW cleaning out that culvert. It's been the Maxwells and the Melansons and people in the neighborhood, because we don't want it rising in our backyard or in our cellars.
So there's a new guy taking over.
So we guys have been out there with our rakes and whatever, doing the best we could to just keep it open.
Yeah, but you're talking about in front of it, not in it.
Well, I've never gone underneath, no. But right up to the edge, yes.
Right. No, I think that would be a good idea to get the DPW to look at that, because it did have the mud on the bottom. And, you know, when there's a really good flow, that's going to be clean.
Yeah.
Yep.
A lot of times.
And I'm getting
a little bit of gravel in front of it, too.
Right. A little clean out.
Any questions from the commission members?
Yeah, I had one more question.
Yep.
So usually we have our rain gardens there. I was just wondering about, I was looking at the plan and I just noticed it now that the connectivity between the rain garden where it's in the spillway to the to where the wetland is a pretty great distance. In other projects, we've had the spillway right in the 25-foot line, and I mean the whole purpose is to deliver that water into the wetland. So, you know, I think you guys put it there because maybe you thought that's the only spot for it, or I don't know if there was an engineering reason for that.
Pretty much, we wanted to catch the flow of the front yard coming down this direction, and with the 25-foot there, we started with the 75. 3-1 went to 76, and then we went to 76.5 to give the inch of storage in that area. With it being an existing grade of 75 in that area, I didn't want to dig down too deep and then have it be groundwater and not be effective. So with the filter media, the soil mixture about 1.5 feet beneath it, you're going to have that, it'll behave properly. I mean, we could lower it down a little bit more. And we're not against moving this down also. There is a tree right there also that. So we're not against making this or sending it down that direction.
Do you see that just being like sheet flow over the berm and then down the side? That's all you see, yeah.
Right, there'll just be a little bit of a saddle right there.
Yeah.
So you'd have it'll be loam and seeded with good root system. If it becomes an issue, you could always just insert some flat rocks, but not the native rocks on the site to armor it a little bit.
You know, I understand what they're saying, but maybe you could get closer, maybe it's something that...
Some kind of a swale, taking it closer to...
Well, if it was, I mean, it's native plants, and if it would be, if we could move that into the ZMV, that would create a lawn that doesn't exist on this property. So, I mean, they could extend all that. I don't know if anyone wanted to offer that to them,
That's kind of what I'm seeing.
I think I'm open to either. You know, I think I see the positive of both. If the applicant has a preference, I mean, again, I see your point. If it's something that you looked at where you were trying to, I know we get really strict with the lines here,
right.
And if you're trying to stay outside of the 35-foot zone, this is certainly something that I don't think we would have an issue if you wanted to move it in and get more grass. But I think I'm fine with either.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that you knew you had options in that spot.
Can we talk about the options of alternative one versus alternative two?
Yeah.
As a 2-to-1 replication for that finger. Do you see what the difference is? The first alternative one isn't a wetland. It's got a lot of leaf litter, quite a bit of leaf litter. There are some skunk cabbage growing up, but not much else. And then alternative two is in an upland area. However, it's a fairly good habitat. You know, it has a nice shrub layer, providing habitat. And, you know, Dave will corroborate that.
Mm.
There was a little bit of a couple buckthorns in there, but other than that, there's high bush blueberry, cinnamon fern, some mature trees, and to get back there, you know, it's further back in the wetland area.
So are there more invasives in the alternative one area?
There aren't any. There's only skunk cabbage, but but it's, you know.
It's upland skunk cabbage?
No, it's skunk cabbage is obligate.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a wetland. I just
okay.
wanted to make sure
okay.
the commission members knew the difference
okay.
between the two alternatives.
Okay, simply revegetation versus creation of new wetland.
Revegetation
mm-hmm.
gotcha.
And so yeah, there's
and
other things to
move
think about. There to actually get to that second area, you would have to drive in there.
Right.
More disturbance.
Right. More disturbance. yeah, it's a nice place back there. If they could reach in and do any of that work that's further out by hand, you know, alternative one, which I'm thinking is the closer one to Haverhill Street, has the easiest access and causes the least disturbance. But that's the question that I think Mike had about, you know, it is a wetland already. It's just covered in
yeah.
leaves.
Yeah. Well, I think if we're talking about replication, I think we're talking about new wetland area. So I would lean towards alternative two.
I just think there's more disturbance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And disturbing a nice buffer that's
oh.
already there.
So I guess my compromise to that would be, you know, is it, so the just to understand alternative one, the 400 and, yeah, so it's that line. I guess what I would like make offer as a compromise that I would accept is maybe a little bit more area as alternative one, because I, you know, going back further in that area, you know, I realize that it is delineated as a wetland now. I mean, we just had another application where there was a big pile of something that was probably on a wetland before, and you know, we're accepting that they're improving the condition of what's out there today. It's this is not a from what I've seen, it's not like a small leaf pile. This is a true work, true revegetation and creating an area. So I think I would be open to alternative one. You know, I don't have a necessarily like, is it 500 square feet or 550 square feet, but like something that is maybe a little bit more square footage.
So there's a large sensitivity to creating more wetlands on this property with the neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Would you accept just more planting?
Sure.
Around that area and just keeping the wetland where it is, maybe that would be better than creating more wetlands.
I'm fine with that as well.
Okay.
But I think I see that as this is the area that needs help. You know, this is the area that I'd like to see the improvement. Why mess something, you know, mess with something that's already looks like it's thriving?
So to that end, maybe that's why that 1,300 area of leaf litter that's going to be removed, I think it says in note 5 it's going to be planted with high bush blueberry, is what I'm reading there, which would be a continuation of habitat area, connecting the two areas we're talking about.
I think now you've got, so that's a good point, Annika. So I think now you've got this big area that is just improved, and then now we've revegetated another area that is currently covered and elevated.
And that would be all handwork for the leaf litter area.
Yeah, right. Your alternative too, I don't think would be handwork. You'd have
it'd be
to
very
get,
difficult to do handwork
right.
back in there to get down to elevation, proper soil mix in there, and then revegetation.
I think between alternative one, revegetation there, and also planting of high bush blueberry and taking out the leaf litter, that's going to improve that whole little stretch.
Mm-hmm. Well.
And how it functions.
Building on Mike's comment, would you be adverse to adding more high bush blueberry or Cornus amomum or racemosa or some of the other ones?
We can add 12 more additions. We're not filling this wetland. This is just a local bylaw waiver request. So this is still staying.
Yep.
We've
right.
proven that we can do it. So
right.
if the alternative is better there, we'll add 12 shrubs. And we'll also go along the stream and clean that up and make sure it's flowing properly with that ongoing condition.
Okay.
So you can add 12 additional shrubs
within that whole within this whole area, you know, within
the whole leaf litter area
or in other fringe areas that you may suggest.
So I think we've agreed that we're going to keep alternative one where it's turned into a wetland the same size. We're just adding more plants above, and I would suggest not putting so many high bush blueberries. I think we've maxed those out. There could be some other alternatives out there, and I think you have a wetland scientist, and he may have some good suggestions because he's been out there, what, 3 or 4 times now.
Well, there is a wetland shrub plant list, so you could add.
Yep, you could just choose from that.
So we can say amend alternative one to expand alternative one to include the entire leaf litter area of 1,300 square feet.
Sure.
Right.
I think that will even provide some additional storage because you're removing those 1,300 square feet.
No
additional
storage.
Do
we have this right?
So
I just want to make sure we have this right.
Because
you're only excavating in the original alternative one area.
Is
what's above it, you're just going to plant.
Sure. Is okay. leaf litter not getting removed in?
No, the leaf litter will be removed.
Okay.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the leaf litter.
But there's an elevation
the
difference as you're going up towards that
yeah.
driveway.
Right.
I just wanted to make sure we're not excavating that
no.
whole
no.
area.
No, I'm talking about the leaf litter.
Yeah, leaf litter
we'll
goes.
Just move
yeah.
back down to existing green.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah.
So many details.
Yeah, little details.
Members of the commission, are we all set?
I have no additional comments.
No, I have no more questions.
Do we have any comments, questions from the community?
Yeah, Tom Hopper, 90 Bethel Road. I live across the street from the Maxwells. I'm concerned, I'm a little late to the game here, the first time I got here. I kind of oppose this, but you know, I'm only one person, but I already have water table problems with rainstorms, and I want to know how that's going to affect the water table in my house across the street.
It's new culvert going across the street.
That area is a lower grade.
Do you mean across the street on Haverhill or Batch Elder?
Batch Elder.
On this
over
side?
Here.
Yeah.
Okay.
So wouldn't the street act like a dam?
I'm telling you right now, when it rains, I have water in my driveway.
You're identifying something that almost is impossible for water to get from one side to the other.
So
I mean, I know
question.
You see this,
I'm asking
but...
I'm a question of what...
Yeah.
So it's just, are they raising that level? Because right now that's a low pitch area. I mean, how much are they raising it, where the house is gonna be? To the street level?
It'll be raised a little bit above the street level, but we do have a stone trench for the driveway, then we have a swale to bring any water that's currently go this way down to the rain garden, then in this direction. I was out there before the meeting, so your house has a little undulating front yard, and there's typically a crown on the road, so that's your rainwater is causing concerns on your side, our rainwater is causing concerns on our side of the road, so I don't think the two mix.
Well, it's not just that, I have other neighbors that have raised the front of the yard too, so it's just the whole area is what I'm concerned about. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, and as probably mentioned before, that's an established deer path. This deer is going through the same spot right through the house all day. So I'm not sure if that's going to make any difference to the commission, but that's their path right there through the area.
Yeah,
they go there now. As soon as they plant their bushes, they're going to be eating the bushes.
Yeah.
They'll still go there.
You're going to start getting more deer.
Still go there.
Deers don't usually care.
I'm more concerned about that, you know, snow removal. Where's the snow going to go?
Yeah, we didn't talk about that. Where's the snow going to go?
Because right now the only place is between Phyllis's house.
This is the driveway.
It'll be right in the front yard on this side.
There's nowhere else to put it.
Yeah.
Carol Luciniak, 84 Bachelor Road. I know you're going to be clearing out the leaves that are there, but there's going to be continuing. Leaves are going to continue to fall and clog this up. So who's going to maintain, you know, keeping all that clear and keeping the stream open? And
the applicant will, but what we've seen is that's not natural leaf litter from the trees. That has been deposited there from grass clippings and leaves on other property. And, you know, we in Reading have a compost area that everybody can take their things.
It's a rule that's not enforced quite enough, but you're not allowed to dump into the wetlands.
You're filling wetland area when you do that.
Right.
And you disturb, you know, the biome of
yeah,
the natural wetland,
that,
so
yeah,
that it's
make sure that
it's kind of a violation of the Wetlands Protection Act. So, you know.
So we'll write the enforcement order, but we can't be on every site in Reading. So if you make a call that there's been some leaf dumping in that area, be happy to go out and check it out and find out what's going on. And if it's not getting cleaned up, we have the ability to write a fine or an enforcement order. But again, that was a man-made pile of leaf debris.
Barbara Melanson, 704. Chuck, do you still have those pictures I gave you of that area flooded?
I do. I'll have to go and get them. Oh, let me make sure they're not missing.
They were taken over a couple different decades to show the time span that it does flood and it holds the water. And my concern is that when this area is lowered, it's going to hold more water, and my garage level is going to take it, the water in. Because with water being held right alongside my driveway there, my garage is lower than my driveway.
Are you on this side?
I am.
Right. Oops.
And it looks like all the water in the property is draining southeast, which is where I am, intended to go to the culvert, but none of that water that is going to be in this holding pond is going to go uphill into that culvert. It never does. Long after the stream is dry, that water is still sitting there. And to dig it lower is going to make it worse.
Actually, we're no longer digging it lower. We're just removing what's been dumped, you know, piled up over time.
And you're going to excavate to do the plantings, right?
Well, the plantings will just be shovel.
May
I speak? That was in alternative two. We've almost decided upon alternative one, which would be just the leaf litter area and not excavating on the northwesterly side of that with alternative two, if that helps.
Did you understand where alternative two and alternative
two? Yes, clearly.
Okay.
Control shift minus.
Oh.
I don't know why it's half, but there's some water. Is that, does anyone can see that? You can zoom in?
Yeah.
Those are old pictures, so you can see the trees aren't nearly as mature as they are now.
Chuck, can you just zoom into one of them? Thank you.
So this is the head wall right here?
Okay.
That's the head wall?
What's that?
This is the main road?
Yeah.
That's
mm-hmm.
Haver Street, yes.
Here's the head wall. This is the defined ditch. That's about 2 feet wide. Almost looks like it's been cleaned out too with the sides there. And then
we've been cleaning it out for years.
So that's no different than my house in Stoneham also. The first one I bought, I was always going and clean up around the neighborhood also. So you're doing a good job there. This is a little bit higher, so this does, wetlands do have undulating land and it does hold pockets and puddles of water. With this cleaning out, I think it's with the removal of what's in there that will drain down. It's not going to be a large puddle. If it does, it'll just be a couple inches.
The area you're talking about where the leaves are is beyond that.
It's all in this area here.
It's beyond that.
Right. It extends over towards your driveway. Mm-hmm. What I mentioned earlier was that it's not uncommon for water to be flowing through that channel with all the runoff from it coming from off our property. And also this area is also influenced from originally from water coming off your driveway onto our land also.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not surprising that that water might puddle there and then make its way over, especially if it's being bermed up here over time with additional mud coming up over there. So that if we can just keep a hydraulic connection between this area and that area, then that would allow that to keep going, flowing away from your land.
To address the driveways flowing into that, those properties were cut back in 1950. And at that time, this piece of property was designated as a no-build zone because it does take the runoff of all of the properties around it.
Yes. I'm not saying it's a negative thing that your driveways are flowing onto the property. I'm just, when I went out there and noticed it, there is a low point on your side of your driveway where it comes down off your garage doors and from your street where the sidewalk is, and it sheet flows off onto our property, which is fine. And then it goes down to the head wall. So there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just trying to say that we're not flowing towards you. You're flowing onto us and down to the head wall.
Actually, you are, because where your water is going into your, forgotten what you call it. The rain garden, thank you.
Yes.
And then that's going to drain further south, heading toward that stream.
But that's up here.
Yes,
and
it is.
And that's going to take a left into the pipe and underneath the stream.
If it goes into the pipe.
Well, this is lower than here, so this is a saddle right now. So it's 72 in here, then there's a 73 is up near the head wall, then 74 comes around off the property on both sides, and it's 75 to 76 up near your driveway. And if you have the map, check on the
sure.
the contouring. So right now, the invert labeled is 72.2. There's an existing 73 contour that's in here. The stream comes through, and that's pretty much at that 72.2 to 72.5 through that area because it's been dug out over time. The 74 comes along here and then chases and comes around the top of the leaf litter pile. There's a 75, which is a heavier contour right along the property line. Then there's a 76.1 right at the corner of this driveway. And you're about 70, the 76 comes like this onto your driveway. It's about 75.7 here. And your garage door is above there. And it's higher over here, so the water comes down off your driveway now into here, hits the 75, 74, and makes its way down to this ditch into 73. Our rain garden up here is at 75 to 76. If it does overtop, it's going to go 76, 75, into this Finger Lake projection, and then down to the 74, to the 73, and out. It's not possible to go back uphill that way. And we did have all the spot grades that I sent you in the email. So it is lower in the middle. So it's basically the water's coming down both sides and out this way.
I don't agree with you because I've had that flooded right up to my driveway.
It might rise up from all the water collectively, but if you're just taking the isolated part of this area, if it only rains on this part of the land.
I I use that as an example.
Oh, no, I'm just, right.
The water collectively from this property, it floods right up to my driveway.
Right, well, this is part of a lot, the larger watershed that does come to this end.
Could I ask another question? I'm looking at the map, and I don't see the dimensions of the house. I've sort of measured it myself, and I'm coming up with a 28 by 46. And with the bump out, that's almost 3,000 square feet. And this house, it's twice the size of mine in the neighboring houses. But where I'm going with this is the property is not a full-size lot to begin with, and it's being grandfathered in to build. And
that's something we can't really address.
Who does?
We have to just look at the wetlands and
okay.
So the size or how it conforms with zoning, that's not something that we can.
So is that another committee after this?
I think you meet regulations. I'm not sure. You may want to address that. I don't think you have any other.
As far as I know, this is a legal buildable lot. It is grandfathered in because it was created before the zoning regulations in 1953, which creates a grandfathered situation. So nothing, this has been owned by one property owner. It has never been owned by an adjoining property owner. So it meets the regulations for that portion of it. As
these
for the
properties
but John, you're
at
also
1950.
Going, well, one second. You, that actually is going to be discussed. Is that?
I was just speaking about the lot size. I haven't talked about any of the other zoning requirements.
So you have to go to another meeting.
I still have to
yeah.
go to the building department once they have permission,
so
or once they get past this point. So.
And you think that's going to go to a meeting about the zoning and all that?
I'm not sure on how. I'm sure it's going to be some type of meeting.
He has to go through conservation first before he can take this next step. So it's like rungs in a ladder. Sometimes
yes.
they happen at the same time, but in this case, I think what was asked is to see if even conservation would approve this lot. So that's the first step. Second step, some of your questions have to do with zoning, and that would be Glenn Redman. So you
okay.
need to talk to the building commissioner about any of those. So their hours are 7 to 5:30, 7 to 7 on Tuesdays.
I have it, thank you. Okay, and to address all the blueberry bushes that are going in there, I think it's great if it's
like
a blueberry farm, but there are
some
blueberries out there now, and they don't do anything. They survive, they don't grow, and they don't produce. So they're not feeding animals, and new ones will not either.
Do you have another suggestion
for planting?
Plants?
My suggestion is leave it alone. Let nature take care of it the way it has.
So let the seed bank that's in the ground now just come through?
It's seed bank of what?
Of whatever seed is in the soil at this moment. Are you saying just let that grow? You know, as they cut back the trees, there's going to be more light and the seed bank will start sprouting. So are you suggesting just let whatever's there naturally start to grow? Or would
no, I'm not suggesting that at all.
I think the point can be taken that a lot of us, we tend to just say blueberry bush, blueberry bush, blueberry bush. There are a lot of other plantings that can be that are acceptable in this area. I think it's worth it to consider some of those other items that are on there. And we had that discussion already.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah, there were other plants.
Certainly blueberry bushes are, you know, fine. I mean, we
yeah.
can improve the blueberry bushes, but if he wants to change them, they want to change them later on. Or
native.
They are part of the project, so they have to survive. They don't have to flower and bear fruit, but they do have to survive. So if they're not bearing fruit, I don't know. We never really got into that before.
Just there's other options besides blueberry bushes. It's just the one everybody knows.
Like an orange tree or something.
Yeah,
like
an orange tree.
Yeah, that's right.
Potential. Can I ask another question?
Certainly.
On the driveway side near my property, I'm assuming, I don't know this to be a fact, that some of the big trees there are going to be removed.
Yeah,
right on the line. Will any of those be replaced with anything?
There are replacements along, I believe the
is it the 25 zone natural vegetation that I see?
25 is back here, behind the driveway. There's maybe feet off the property line, so there'll be a privacy fence proposed along the edge. In the stone trench, there'll be additional 4 or 5 feet more. That'll be level.
And there's trees along the Batchelder side.
Mm-hmm.
A combination of sugar maple and dogwood will be added in.
But I'm asking about the line on my driveway.
Right.
Is there anything going in there?
We don't have anything on the plan there for trees going in. It'd be close to the house, too close to the house for us to put anything in there, aside from maybe a small hedge.
Are you asking for privacy for that reason?
Hmm.
There is that 6-foot fence that's going to be on the property line.
But that's not much. I mean, this house is going to tower over mine. Mine's a ranch. I'm not thinking just for myself, but whoever comes behind me.
So it looks like there's only two. There's actually four or so trees, I guess.
Well, I think.
Oak, maple.
I don't see much
14.
Room there for additional trees.
No.
I think you're welcome
you
to plant
some,
on your side.
Are you're keeping some? There's a 14-inch maple, 10-inch maple, and a 14-inch oak. Are those being removed?
The ones that are on my side of the property line are being removed. It'd be hitting the house with the branches and
okay.
the nails. So. And when I dig for the excavation, it would probably disturb the root system.
Yeah.
And it'd probably be coming down naturally soon thereafter.
Along Batchelder and Batchelder and Haverhill, you said the trees were sugar maple and what was the other species?
It's in note number.
By right there on the note, things.
It's in note number 2 or 3. The dogwood, I can't remember what.
Nope.
Sugar maple and dogwood.
Note 3.
Yeah, I see it.
So, you know, in that situation, I mean, there's a fence there now. It doesn't look like there's much room for anything else, but there we've 37 James Road has a similar issue, and they put in abrevieties, and then just bought big abrevieties. So something could be put in there, but I think nothing's going to shade that house. Because of how close it is to line, how big it's going to be. So, and then the proximity of the trees to the structure are going to be problematic. So they really do have to come down for safety reasons.
Okay, do I hear a motion?
Can I address one of the things? I'm looking at the fence. It looks like the fence through the property is also being relocated.
The fence in the back of the property was at the 35-foot line, and I had mentioned to John that we don't usually restrict fences inside the 25-foot line. So he's moved it back.
So it's going to go right up to the wetlands?
It's
you think
looks
five
like
feet?
It's within
five feet off the wetlands.
Yeah.
And then crossing directly through the wetland finger.
It's a post and rail fence, and there's not going to be much obstruction going with that, and I guess he could kind of work from both edges and head in either direction if that was an issue, but if anyone on the commission wants to discuss the post and rail fence going through the wetland finger.
I'd prefer it stay out. If for a physical barrier between the land and the wetland.
So just span over it.
OK, Cause
oh, you mean
opening.
No posts in?
The post
yeah.
wouldn't be in the finger. Is that something
like
that could be done?
I mean, I don't know. We have a. It's. I think it can. I think we've allowed mitigation for this to not really be counted in, you know, what we've asked for. I mean, either deny the mitigation and propose an option or example number one, and say, you know, you got to be 35 feet away from the wetland finger, or accept it and then allow. Allow what they're proposing, which is the fence and the house closer than 35 feet. I mean, you can't, it's either all or nothing.
Yeah, they're not proposing to fill this finger, but this finger is being replicated.
Through alternate one.
You could put the fence around the finger, too. I mean, they already got a variance.
Well, that's what we're discussing, but on different, we're discussing it, but we're not discussing about going around it.
I could also put a brick in the fence.
Yeah.
And stop it before the and after the wetland finger.
So there'll be no fence inside.
That way it's
well.
Not in the.
Well, you could put a post either side of it so that it's not actually in the finger.
Correct. I don't know. I think it's probably
it's
like 13 feet,
fan.
So I'd have to stop it and then start it, you know, on
yeah.
the opposite side of the finger,
it's
which
not
is fine.
No, I don't think it. I don't see a problem with it going across the finger because you're replicating it.
I mean, this isn't a
we're kind of disregarding it.
Wetland situation. Were you out at the site? Did you,
yeah,
s- you
I've,
saw
I've
you saw
been
that
out to the site.
Finger?
I'm just saying. It's a little, from a plan perspective, it appears a little nonsensical that it would go through the wetland finger.
Rest assured, this is a pine-laden depression with hardly any, if none, wetland in it. It was delineated based on soils.
Gotcha.
And I think the comment when we were out there,
okay.
someone thought it was a truck, double truck tire that made it.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't me that said that, but it's... It has, I mean, it has value. I don't want to say that, but it doesn't deserve, after it's been replicated, this much discussion.
And also, there are openings that would allow small mammals and amphibians
right.
to pass
right.
through, and that's...
It's
right.
like a 5-foot
right.
round post.
Right, that's...
I've been trouble.
Maybe it's a mahogany...
That would be my concern if
right.
they couldn't, you know.
5 inch.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to continue.
Okay.
Wait a second.
Yeah, we'll continue.
What are we doing? Why are we continuing?
Okay, if not, you can vote it down and make another motion.
Motion on the floor. Is there a second? No second.
Wait a minute. Stop.
Can we regroup? So what are we looking for? What is left here?
I think we've decided on alternative one.
Mm-hmm.
We're okay with the fence across the finger.
Yep.
Is there any additional information
yeah.
that the applicant needs to give us? Even if, so whether we continue or not, Chuck still needs to prepare.
Yeah,
so,
correct.
But is there any additional items that we're waiting for from the app?
I don't think so.
I think we asked for additional planting above the alternative number one that we discussed and gave the applicant the option to move the rain garden into the 25-foot area. And
rather than having that be open-ended, I mean, do you guys have a preference for the rain garden?
If the commission is leaning towards approval of alternative one and closing, I would leave the rain garden as is tonight if that was the only outstanding item. That's just my thoughts.
I think also add filter fabric to that construction.
The filter, there's a little bit of, whether we close or not tonight, there's like a plan with all the changes that we've asked.
So I think we're in a position where Chuck can start preparing the. I mean, you've done this before. Chuck can start preparing the.
Dope.
Order. Thank you. Sorry. The order, and whether it's continued or not, we can close and approve at the next meeting, assuming we get the additional information. So I'll second that considering.
Anything else the commission? commission is requesting?
I don't.
So what are you proposing? Are you continuing or are you approving?
Now I'm lost. I guess I'll make a motion to close. I think we've got everything we need.
I don't know if we can accept this from Mike. He's been up a lot.
He's got a new,
a new dad.
I think we need someone else to make a motion.
Thank you.
It's not impacting.
I make a motion to close. I think we've got what we. I think there's very minor details at this point that we need. I think Chuck, you know, we don't need to approve the order if we haven't gotten the information we have at the next meeting.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
Thank
Sorry
you
for
very
the confusion.
Much.
No problem. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
We're sending this to you to say that we would like the meeting to August 23rd. Meeting.
Sounds like you're trying to prepare.
So they're continued till the 23rd.
So I have an email. We have performed an additional ground survey that Ryan requested, but he's out on vacation. We assume the commission wouldn't make any discussions in our absence. Mike Toolhill is also on vacation. So they are just waiting until their team gets back together and they're going to submit a new plan. And what they're doing is they've taken shots of the impoundment area, and it will tell us where it's going to flood to, but it's not going to tell us what the cause, what that new impoundment area will cause upstream. So you would need a H&H study to do something like that, but we're going to look, well, the engineering department would look at this first and then move forward with whether they need more information or not.
So you, when you say shots, you're talking about a survey.
Yeah.
A survey.
Yeah, a survey. If they're going to do a survey, wherever, you know, wherever that impoundment area
goes.
So, yeah, it could be 100 feet back or could be less.
Whatever. We'll see what they come up with. The impoundment area, I mean, we're talking about fractions of inches, though, right?
Could be. It depends upon where it, you know, what the, I don't know what the topography is. It's kind of hard to, when you're at that site, to see anything that's really just more than 100 yards up that lane, because it makes a bend off to the left. But I don't know whether there's anything that's on the USGS map, or whether that's finite enough to look at that.
Oh no, you gotta, this is a very detailed survey.
So
it's a lot of mosquito bites, that one.
Yeah.
All right. So, request to continue. They need some information from the engineering department, something about a 36-inch culvert, and it was on private property, so they didn't want to go in there, according to their survey manager. And there was a discussion at the site that surveys are allowed even on private property in Massachusetts, and I didn't know anything about that, so I stayed out of it, but that was the discussion they had, but their survey manager felt like that he didn't want to test that. So he's asking the engineering department for some additional information and maybe a layout plan of some culverts that are up gradient from the driveway crossing. So Ryan's out until Monday. We hope we can get that to them before, well, in time to get our application and our, you know, our packets together. So.
Are they up against a certain amount of time pressure to actually fix that?
I could.
I don't know, it's.
They'd like to have done it in the dry.
I want to do it in the dry and before the bad weather comes, freezing weather comes.
But then, why not next year? There wasn't any.
Sometimes winter's the best time to do it.
Yeah.
So
it's not like it's something where there's not some mandate from some other agency or something to fix it in a certain period of time.
I think so. It would apply for the
emergency permit.
Bypass of the emergency permit.
Old new business? 306 Main Street?
306 Main Street. Our three-tiered plan was to move the vegetation plan to the existing permit, which we did a couple meetings ago. And once that happened and was recorded and received the correct paperwork and fees, we could issue the two certificates of compliance for number 270-63, which was a simple remodeling project. I believe it was back in 88. And then, which was the original oil spill 270-492. The 492 oil spill is closed out. There are no issues. Maybe Anika could speak to this better than I could, but there's
point.
No issues outstanding. So once it's closed out, if they discover new issues, that's something different. The owner will own that. But they're working with Michael Richard, who was the original LSP from Tyree. So he's gone private. The new owners hired him to be part of his project. And when they bring this forward with a notice of, well, they're actually going to use the original notice of intent, but they will come in and discuss what they're going to do as courtesy to the commission, and then we'll move forward from there. So we're ready to sign the two orders of condition, closing them out, and issuing certificates of compliance. I have prepared them.
So we have received the documentation we needed.
Yes, Jack Sullivan did an as-built plan.
Mm-hmm.
We made the change order. That change order was recorded on the final plan, which is still in effect.
Yep.
I've talked to the owner. He has assured me that he knew about the fact that he's taking on that planting,
okay. And
he has no problem with it. That's even outside of us being able to enforce that to happen. So. Order of conditions 270-063 has no ongoing conditions that I saw in the order, so there's no second page to that.
I make a motion to close.
Move we issue the certificate of compliance for 270-63.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
I'll let you do the next one. It's not even 10.
The second one? Is that RGB or is that the one that's staying open?
No, the second one also was, this was the one that was part of the oil spill and that closeout and all these things that happened.
Make a motion to approve the order of conditions.
This does have ongoing conditions, but they have nothing to do with the oil spill.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Is 60 Nina Circle selling or something?
Don't know. This I was contacted by a lawyer who needed to obtain this certificate of compliance. I have gone past the property. This was a subdivision And there's, you know, at this point, it was all about erosion control. The site is fine. I didn't see any reason to hold it up or to remove leaf litter or anything like that when I went out there.
I move we issue the certificate of compliance for 1988-1 16 Eno Circle.
And you might notice that it's a bylaw order of conditions.
Yeah.
Which is...
What does that mean?
It just means
it,
so I don't know if it was even recorded on. Well,
was there anything, just because we ran into this before, there wasn't anything like they needed to turn over land or in the order?
To the Conservation Commission, like I said, Eno Circle was a subdivision.
Mm-hmm.
And this was just one house.
Just
on
one
it.
Of the houses
yeah.
that, and they never got.
Do you remember you could go and pick blueberries at the farm? You guys weren't around, huh?
No.
I was three.
Oh.
Thanks for sharing that.
I don't feel bad at all.
It was a farm.
Well, that's cool. Back when Reading was rural.
Well,
pretty
there are a couple farms. Actually. You know those apartments on West Street? There's a farm back there.
Mm. Ben's farm.
Yep.
Mike, who were the two? Did you know?
Go on, Nick. Good call.
Motion in a second.
Mm. I
wow,
know.
Okay, so that's, that makes sense.
I think it was Anita that brought it up.
Right,
so she, you motioned to issue, and then who
Dave
seconded?
I seconded.
All those in favor?
Sweet.
Yeah,
that's
it.
I think that property is selling.
In a circle?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple old favorites coming up.
Elizabeth Cummings.
Good.
Yeah.
Austin Prep?
Yeah, we get into Austin Prep, but I just wanted to say that Azalea Circle, if anyone was around for that. No,
I was around for that.
Is coming back, and we have a new planning, community planning director, and she looked at it, and she had some questions if it really meets zoning at this point. Just questions at this point, but, it was an approved two lot house, and it seems like there's some questions around that now. But if they get through past her, we'll be seeing this again, because the first order of conditions, which I think you might have been around for, in one of your stints here, expired, or they withdrew it when they came in with the second one. Because they went to DEP, there was a big back and forth. I don't think Reading ever agreed to it. And they withdrew that, and they said, we're not going to fight with you. We're just going to submit another notice of intent. And they did that, and we gave them one to build two houses. They never went forward, and it expired.
Yeah, that was a long time ago.
Because it was issued 2012. But in November, not in like September or something like
so
that. It was like
qualify
like,
for
like
the
2 months or something. Yeah. So they didn't get the Extension Act.
That was a site where they, where the commission, after a lot of debate, permitted a 2 to 7 foot house overhang of the 35-foot zone.
It was.
They wanted their house a little bit bigger, and we approved, even though the 35 went under, we approved this overhang of the house. I remember that one.
Not,
interesting.
I was, yeah, that was Tom Hughes.
Yeah, it was Tom
Hughes. That brought to us. And I don't think anybody was happy with the outcome. I mean, I think they weren't happy, and I don't think the commission was happy. Got to this point, and
nobody was happy.
That kind of really that project kind of established that 35-foot line.
It did.
So we've been keeping people out of the 35-foot, but up to it since then. So
to the point of cantilevering your house.
There are consequences.
Well, it's not considered in zoning.
it's your foundation.
Right.
It's not the, not the structure. So if you cantilever the structure 3 feet over, it's your foundation. It's not your cantilever.
The bylaw says you can do that too.
So, Austin Pratt.
Can I read it?
To what?
Bring up one side. Press control and zoom into one.
Is that what you want to do?
No, I just want to, I want to even it off. It's not straight.
Oh, no.
Try to put something under one side of your laptop.
So this is pretty simple. This is just director, blah, blah, blah.
Better in color.
I think I sent that out to you.
Yeah, you
know, maybe wants to start in on it, but let me see. I have here. So, Mary
Trudeau
has looked at this and made some changes, and we're being asked if we approve of the changes, and she will go ahead with her planting. Let me see if I can find that email. Here's a plan for Mary Trudeau with additional
notes?
Plantings.
Possible locations, use judgment.
What?
Are those her notes? The possible locations, use judgment?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that's, it sounds like it's a little loose, but field conditions will allow you to find a spot, especially when it's planted and I don't know, 87% of it is staying. So here's a plan from Mary Trudeau from and has additional plantings for the Austin Prep site. On your go-ahead, I will commence with the plantings and and removal of the two oaks and the dead cedars as discussed. So we did have a site walk and we did that with John Weber and he liked the wetland. He liked, you know, it's always nice for someone to appreciate, you know, having this learning tool in their backyard and they have a nice sign up there like we asked. And he just, you know, they just want to get this thing done. I know that. So we're down to a couple of plants. Mary Trudeau is qualified to make these changes. She actually spotted the same inconsistencies with the original plan that our own chair of the commission did. And so I think, you know, this looks like a good plan to me. If anyone's looked it over and has some comments, I can pass those on. But I'm just looking for an okay tonight.
Looks okay to me.
I don't see any issue.
Yeah. Do I hear a motion?
I move we approve the plan as submitted tonight.
Second.
All those in favor?
I'm glad that they are moving those oaks.
Yeah. That's a good catch, Dave.
Right next to the track. They start dropping acorns coming around the roundhouse turn.
That is one ugly ankle.
You know, it's like, ooh, awful.
Yeah.
Either that or the tendrils that they drop in the spring. That's like when that rains on
slippery.
That. Yeah, that's like
death.
It's gross.
Okay.
Everybody take a deep breath. Hold it.
Cleanse.
You ready?
14 Strawberry Hill.
14 Strawberry Hill.
Okay.
This, I have two plans here. I don't know which one's better to look at.
Did we? I can't wait to
no,
hear
you
what's
didn't.
Different.
I, got, I just got that one, and I got this.
I did. Good for you.
I'm going to pass this on to the chair, because I read it. And
I looked at it.
What is this?
That's from the pool service, trying to explain my question, because Dave asked how much square footage of impervious was added between the approved pool area and this new. Let me zoom in on it.
this new area, and that's what we're looking at. So you can see in gray, and gray is what we approved, and what's red is what we're presented with when they came in for a permit. So this is Strawberry Hill. This is another oldie but goodie. It's like dropping your cat off at the end of the, you know, town line and finding it in the kitchen when you get back home.
Mm-hmm. My dad does that.
Yes. Thanks, Chuck.
Ugly
childhood memory. Thanks, Chuck.
The walkway, what was the proposed
walkway?
So it's
a net increase, though. It is an increase.
Is it?
Yes.
So there was, we didn't understand some of this. I mean, Dave really looked at it. I don't know if you want to speak, but Dave, it looks like there's more pool. I'm gonna say apron, but it might be pool patio area.
Yeah. Can I show you what the difference is?
Yeah.
You went through the effort.
You have a scanned copy of that, so I can put it on the board.
That's what the that's.
Yeah.
The hatched area is the increase, but there's a two little triangles that are outside, but there's more hatched area than the two triangles. If this is the originals.
But how much
can we get that in triplicate?
Look, none of you bothered to do this. So suck it up.
No, it is a net increase. I mean, you can
that. This was the original.
So that's before, that's new.
This is
same scale.
This is new, but I also tried to look at what was not. They left this out.
Yeah.
But this was the increase over this. Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Does it have anything from the pool company notes as to what that dotted area is? That exposed aggregate, concrete.
They're saying that it's this new blue 60 techno block for the patio material, which is a permeable paver.
So the new material is a permeable paver where the old bluestone patio was
wasn't.
Not.
That's my understanding.
No, that's not permeable.
Yeah, so.
So they changed it, even though they increased it, they changed it to a permeable material.
Mm-hmm.
So did you get an answer to your one simple question?
No. I didn't get, my question was, I wanted to know what was the net increase of that dotted area versus the hatched proposed bluestone patio.
So I sent that to the owner, the pool company, it's not the same email, and Jack Sullivan, and that's the reply I got, so.
So the pool square footage did not change. The square footage of the pool.
It couldn't. Wasn't
right,
it by
because of
zoning?
Bylaw, zoning bylaw. But at this point, we've gone from impervious material to pervious material. So do we look at that as a benefit because it's pervious material versus having impervious material?
How is it genuine bluestone or is it some?
I
mean, these things are pervious for about a week and a half.
I don't think any of those notes are describing the new material because they're not in red. Does anyone agree with that? I mean, I don't think. So it says top bluestone patio. I don't think that's part of the old.
Right.
Right.
That's the old stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
That's
know,
proposed.
That's
not
no,
top,
say,
that was proposed.
Say,
that was a P.
Oh.
That was proposed bluestone patio.
Mm-hmm.
So now the.
After blue.
It's blue 60.
Blue 60 techno block.
So this isn't aquifer protected district, but that impervious cover concept that we're talking about right now, was that part of the old original order of conditions?
That's what
we approved not to go beyond a certain square foot.
No, I don't
impervious
think we
or no.
Okay. Said that.
It was
say.
Just lot area of vegetated cover that
right.
was going to be retained.
You know, the other thing is
right.
I remember
I think we'd need a spec on this blue 60.
Yeah. What is it? Blue 60 what?
Blue
Technoblock. Blue 60 by Technoblock. BLU 60.
A spec that says it's impervious.
Just manufacturer sheet.
I think that's reasonable. They should be able to get that pretty readily.
And the old one, too. Let's see what the difference is.
So I'm still unclear.
It just says bluestone.
I mean, I think we should know the answer to Dave's question.
What's Dave's question?
The increase
in square footage for the new blue 60 Technoblock versus the old proposed bluestone patio.
Well, if the Concom had a planimeter, we could figure that out, but we don't have one.
What do you need?
Planimeter.
But we can ask the applicant for that information.
Used to do.
Do you want me to just overlay it? I can do it next week.
The thing
it's
is, with
not,
the
not
stylus.
Your responsibility, though.
Right.
But
let's ask them and let's tell.
So Becky, I see what you did, but I don't understand. Like, if I'm looking at that red outline,
mm-hmm.
which is the
yeah.
new proposed
yeah.
outline,
yeah,
what's the old? Is the old where it's all polka dotted?
No, the new is the polka dotted.
The old is just the rectangle.
The old is,
yeah, there you go.
Right.
Plus the pathway to the stairs.
Right. So that was the old.
Plus the pathway.
That's
there's a pathway.
The pathway.
To the
pathway. That's squared. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's it.
That was
and this,
the old. So
this
was
piece,
all grass.
Can I see?
Yep.
This piece.
So that goes away, right?
That goes away, and this little piece too.
Yeah,
but then you've got all this other stuff, you know.
Well, I think. I think we can ask if it's a change in grading. I mean, I'm looking at these rock-looking shapes on one side.
Well, these are steps though, right? These are steps into the pool, these are steps down?
The north side of the pool.
No, isn't that like a...
That's probably
like
just
a,
like a rocks.
Well,
like a
I
feature.
Don't...
Yeah.
I don't know if that's
yeah.
a rock wall. I mean,
what difference is it, would it make?
Well, that's impervious.
Yeah.
It's a rock wall.
So what can I...
There's a lot going on back there.
Is the increase of... if they do come back and say, well, there's an increase of impervious, what's the solution? I mean, is that a problem?
I don't even know if we're at that point yet. I think that what I'm asking the commission, because this is something we need to find out so we can ask those questions, is this a minor plan change? Or I gave Dave the sheet. Is this an amended order of conditions, or is it within the original scope of the project and it's nothing? So, is this so different that we would have to go back and notify the neighbors? To me, it does get a little bit close to that retaining wall in the back, and I remember those neighbors coming in here and saying, how close is this going to be? And the pool was in a different configuration up against the property line, and they changed it to this, which was further away from the property line, which I'm talking about is Jack's plan, not the red plan. And now it's right back there again.
It's right back there, and you know, I think to your point, Chuck, they had that first proposal had walkway all around.
Yeah, and they
patio
were
all around,
yep.
and then they, you know, they cut.
Right.
This portion of it off when they were trying to get it away from the property line. So now, to your point, we're getting right back into that area.
Yep.
So that wasn't discussed, but more or less it wasn't presented to the abutters. And if no one came in, then I don't think I would even entertain my own question, because if no one comes in, then no one really cares. But we did have some interested parties here, specifically about that side. So number 18 of the order that we issued says that any departure or change from the plan has to obtain in writing permission from the Conservation Commission. If deemed major or
substantial, a new public hearing or amended order of condition and or new notice may be required. So that's where we're at.
Would there be a public, would there be notification with an amended?
Yeah. There's no application, but everything's the same, that you send out notice.
So that would give the opportunity to the neighbors to know about this and come to the meeting if they needed to or wanted to.
Right.
I think that's kind of, that's my concern about this. This is considerably different.
The only thing I would say on that, I agree with everything you're saying, but I think that in the purview of the Conservation Commission protecting wetland, the change isn't really all that significant. I think what's different, which may be of concern to the neighbor, is sort of the proximity of kids in the pool to the fence and things like that, but that's not really a wetland issue. I think from the wetland point of view.
But I'm not convinced that that's not.
I don't
know about the permeability versus non-permeability, and that
and
increases.
And I don't know about any additional grading.
And that increases your impervious, and you know how you're going to handle that, and that is.
But I think that's and I think that's how you have to look at.
That's
it.
How that's would be under our
so that's,
jurisdiction.
That's Dave's question. Is this a meaning? Is this more than a 20%?
I don't know.
Right.
And I remember Jamie questioning some of these pavers. Permeable
pavers don't last. It's a great thing that they say. The reality is they.
But they get filled up with sand and stuff, right?
Exactly.
And then they don't work.
Lifespan is really short.
I think it's fine for someone to put out a product sheet that says it's permeable. But this isn't a lab. This is someone's backyard. I mean, you're going to have one season of pollen. And all that pollen's going to be mixed in with the sand, and it's not going to be permeable. It's just going to silt up and.
And they're not going to vacuum sweep that.
I guess my question still stands. What is too much additional impervious? Make the assumption that it's impervious. Beyond a minor plant, you know, to the point where we would take it to beyond a minor plant change. I'm just wondering.
Something like 20 or 25% to me.
Mm-hmm.
More than that would be significant. Right? I mean, clearly significant. You could argue more than 10% significant. But clearly 20 to 25 is, right?
No, I look at it differently. I see that as a. I see Jack's plan, the original agreed to plan, as a combination of all the hard work that the commission put into it with Jack and with the abutters. This is certainly different and hasn't been fully vetted.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when I saw it, I was very surprised that it changed again. And I know the owners don't know the history of that lot, but it just, you know, I guess that's why I made the comment.
I think too, you got to take it at where are we today and what's the change compared to what we approved. The history is not the current homeowner's fault. They bought the lot.
No, but I think you need to understand. I think there's an understanding of how we got to here and the
how
decisions.
How much compromise we've already
the
made.
The decisions
yeah.
that the commissions have
yep.
made
yep.
to get to this point, to get to the point of where it was before.
Yeah.
And now now something comes before us, and we just say, well, it's not a huge difference. Well,
but we
made compromises before to get to there.
And that's why I'm saying if the math says this is only a 7% increase in pervious, then we'd say, that might be okay. If the math says it's 25%, I mean, I can't really judge because of all the curvy lines.
You don't understand Mike's point. If they had brought this to us originally, we may have reduced it down to the size
yeah.
that we're looking at on Jack's plan, and it would have been a free-form pool with more stylish lines to it. Like we're looking at here. This is just, And they keep saying, every time I get an email from them, that the pool's still 600 square feet. Basically, what's your problem, you know? But that comes from the fact that that's the building department measures a pool only by the open water,
right.
600 square feet.
Right.
Whatever else doesn't matter.
No, I understand what you're saying.
So they're getting conservation and building confused.
I know.
But we would look at everything.
Big. If you look at from the distance from the house to
my
the
biggest
edge of the
issue
pool,
with this right now is I don't feel like
that's pretty close.
I don't feel like I have enough information to make a judgment about this
that's
tonight. I don't know if there's additional grading.
The tip of that,
I don't know.
You know, to the other side.
I don't know if any of the plants along the fence were moved to allow that additional patio right up against the fence. I don't know what the impervious nature of the patio new one is proposed and how that's going to be maintained going forward to keep it impervious. You know, there's a lot of unknowns and from sort of a, you know, approach perspective, I'm getting the impression that, you know, it seems kind of consistent with this particular project that, you know, first it was the back chunk of that whole yard was, in my opinion, was going to be vegetated. And then we allowed them to spread out the plants. And so now they've got some yard. And so then they had a pool. And now I think I feel like they're pushing it. I'll be honest, because now they had a little bit of a pool, but now they're like, well, why can't we have more pool? Why can't we have more here? And why can't we just shove all those other plants to this other part? And I think
I'm not in approval of this at this point. Really don't have more pool. The pool is the same size.
Yeah.
And everything that's there, you're talking about the plants, that scorched earth, there's nothing there now. The vegetation is gone, so what they're putting there is 1,000% better than what is there currently. So what they're planning is better. One of the things that I look at here, and I know what you're saying about where this is pushing the boundaries, but you know, I kind of wonder if this pool, because it's getting close to the boundaries here and close to that vegetation. If you were to take that kidney and you would turn that clockwise, counterclockwise, and just turn that back down this way, that would bring the tip of this further away from that back lot line, and then you could kind of slide that down further into the almost the same footprint of where the pool was before, without significantly changing the location of the pool and the square footage of the pool. But that's still, you know, then you still have the what's the material around it and what's the difference in square footage. So, and then we also don't know what those things that look like, you know, stegosaurus, you know, things up at the top of the pool are. You know,
those
probably is one of those freeform rock formations. But I think without really having the detail, it's kind of hard to make a decision based upon, you know, a plan view of some curvy lines.
Yeah, I agree. And I think too the proximity of the shrubs together in the northwest corner, I think that's northwest, the upper left on this plan. I mean, are they so close together they're not even gonna, I mean, they look really close together. I know they're, which hazel?
Lavender.
Winter holly. I don't know how big winter holly is.
Lavender, arborvitae.
But if an inch is 20 feet, those are pretty close together.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, and I could see the, you know, one argument I could see they could make about moving that pool closer to the north property boundary is farther away from the wetland.
That was when Jane was still here. They had, because they were.
No, and that's not necessarily a bad thing from the wetlands perspective.
But some of them, it's already the closest point to the wetland, to the edge of the old pool, is 85 feet.
But we'll give them some.
That's a long way away.
It was 70%.
I mean, where's the 35?
Right.
In this area?
I know, but over
65
feet to the old pool. This is even further away.
Right, but to the edge.
I thought it was just by area.
Patio?
It just added up the areas
know,
of where they were putting pervious pavers and said, okay,
no,
you know.
No, that's not
right.
The pool. This
Even
is
if
the
we
pool,
assume
that's
it's
the
70%.
So it'd be more than 35.
Oh, absolutely.
30,
maybe that's not the site.
So it's
right around
be
the time that that
yep.
50.
Was happening. Because I think that's when we had this discussion. I felt like we applied a percentage.
This is 39.7
to pervious pavers.
From here to here.
Yeah, so this is the thing.
This is
I don't know. I mean, I guess you can ask.
Yeah, and then it goes back down here.
For the for the data sheets, and then find out if they say it. And
mm-hmm.
I think we found out that there was no way to figure that out.
Yeah.
I think we
asked for sheets on that on right around this
yeah.
same time. We asked for sheets on
yeah.
on them.
One ways off.
They basically tell you, yeah, they're great. And we just took a step back.
I
and
think we have enough info. I think we're all in agreement
Jamie
based
had
on that.
Proposed. Well,
you know, if I had some information,
he goes, everything has a number.
The
and
difference
what's
was
that number? It's just, it's not 100, you know?
And we couldn't
this
get a number. I think we arbitrarily selected. We said, well, they're going to use pervious pavers. It's not really pervious.
Technical specifications.
But we'll allow
right.
70%.
It's a lot
you know,
easier to make that decision.
It's 70% of it will be considered pervious or something. We made some sort of compromise to say, well, give us a little extra of that area.
I will say on the impervious question, I remember that meeting and I was brand new to the commission and I kind of went along with it, kind of didn't buy it. Now I really don't buy it. So just because I've thought about it over the last year and I know, water, you know, the little cracks fill up with water and the water sheets right over it when it's raining out. It's just the way it works.
It's poor performance. It there are aspects of it that, you know.
You can do a control test to make it percolate.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's in a thunderstorm, it doesn't percolate. The water runs off.
Yeah. Crushed cone doesn't percolate.
So what is the commission?
Runs off of that too.
Oh, are we still discussing it? I'm not sure. I, you know, based on just there being a lot of discussion, maybe
it sounds like they need to come in.
Need some more information. I could provide it more information, or you might have a decision about whether you want an amended order, because we do have that abutter aspect to this.
Given the other thing I would say,
and they
is
did keep, and I do want to say that they did keep in touch. They called me and they said, whatever happened to this pool situation.
So
who did the abutters?
The abutter behind. They were one of the ones that fell into the crack where they didn't realize that they get notified. They'd only get notified the first time. And
do we have the old plan of the pool, like the first submission that they gave to us? Not this one that's below here, but
the bigger one.
I have the file right here.
I have another.
So there's one rendition.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is exactly what I'm talking about of, like, how did we get to where it is today?
Yeah. I think the other part of that, the other part of that, Mike, is...
Is this the same, Mike?
Is...
Yeah.
We looked at a previous plan and we said yes, and then we look at this and we concentrate on the pool. But what's to say that
shed.
Something else didn't change the height of the retaining wall, the placement of all these trees? We sign off on this plan. We're stuck with this map. And everything else we did is history,
unless,
right?
Unless we only approve
the change
of the pool and the patio
and the rest of it.
As
I think you have to word it that way. I think that's important if we were to go that route. Because, I mean, I've seen us sign off on things, and then no one goes back and checks every single thing on the latest plan that we got. Because you can't.
There is a lot on this plan.
There's so much on this page.
Yeah.
How do we know what trees were here that are gone?
Was before.
Right.
The total, you know, does the total number of trees, is the total number of trees the same? I think all of that comes back into question.
They also had 21'6" to the pool. And this says here 3'4" now. Big difference. 11 feet. Well, they went also further than that way too. It's 11 feet now to the edge, and it was 8'6" before. But that was a rectangle. So this is the first iteration, then the second iteration. That the one that's underneath that grayed out is the one that we actually approved.
Mm-hmm.
Interestingly enough, Chuck, the paper that you gave me was actually very helpful. And it says here about the right of an appeal of an amended order of conditions extends only the amendment. So the when you amend the order of conditions, that opens up again the abutters to the right of an appeal for that change.
But just for the change.
Just for the change. For
everything.
So they could always just go back to the original pool.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 So that gives the neighbors relief if they didn't agree with this, but I'm not even certain at this point. We just don't have enough information about what this is. I don't think we do anyway. I would feel more comfortable with some data on the square footage of the change, and also the setbacks. But you know, it says here the purpose of the project has changed. That's not really the true. The scope of the project has changed. I'm not really certain that really, we don't know what the percentage is, so that's difficult to state. Project as reside meets relevant performance standards, that's true. And the potential for adverse impacts to the protected statutory interest will be increased. There isn't any potential for adverse impact. So, you know, for the in determining whether an amended order of conditions should be issued or a new notice of intent required.
How is it increased?
Impervious in the upland.
Not.
Yeah, but they're saying this blue 60 isn't. It's.
But they haven't shown.
But I think, you know, it's. Even though it's within, it's a long way away. We're also talking that goes uphill as well. There's a pretty significant gradient on that lot.
It's probably only 45 feet away. I don't know if that makes a difference. So, you know, that area there was a vernal pool.
Yeah.
And
I went there 3 weeks, 2 weeks ago, just to look. It was full of water.
Yeah. Full of water. But so it has no inlet or outlet.
So it's now isolated land subject to flooding.
Yeah.
So
it's got a pipe in it. I don't know where that pipe comes from. The pipe that comes in that depression.
We went from a vernal pool to what we have today.
Yeah,
we
sure. So
what did that look like to me when I first saw that?
It just seems like we just keep increasing the impervious on the site. This is a big house.
Exactly.
It was tough enough to get the house through. The first permit took
right.
With the commission that was sitting at that point, they denied it, and then DEP approved it, and then it was approved by the commission.
Right.
So, and through that process, the vernal pool was declassified, and
because
it's no longer
a vernal pool. Because
of this property. I mean, that's just the background, but,
right.
And that's just to say there is something that was valuable enough to be a vernal pool at some point there. It's not one now, but, and it, so it does deserve as much protection as we can give it. And I would actually say that my only issue with what's going on here is the increased amount of area that they're covering, because even pervious, whatever the stuff is called, pervious material they're putting down there isn't grass, and grass isn't trees.
Right.
So, you know, we're just decreasing that value down to, you know, just infiltration. Before it was a pool, and there could have been grass between the patio and the pool apron. There could have been a little bit more pool between the pond, you know. But, you know, one thing that stands out is that neighbor, and I would wonder if that would bother them at all. Is this
holding?
Yeah, is that, and to not give them the opportunity to say anything, I don't know.
Well, at this point, do we have, the responsibility to notify the abutters that there's been a proposed change.
Only if it's an amended order of conditions.
I don't think...
But we would have to actually amend the order of conditions because it's, if we...
What's the word? Yeah.
If we deem it to be a significant enough change. But we, the pool's the same size, I don't know about the surround.
The surround is bigger.
I can tell you, definitely.
The surround is bigger.
Bigger, yeah.
It's bigger.
Yeah.
The surround is bigger.
So we didn't talk about mitigation for the increased in whatever coverage area. So I'm not going to say pervious, but... And again, the what was planted there, will it survive in that proximity? What is the grading going to look like? I think those are good points. I mean, this pool works the same to me. You could basically, I don't know if that's in the lower corner or the lower center part, if that's a fire pit or what that is. But you could have a standalone fire pit and a standalone pool with a small apron around it in this freeform style with grass in between.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all that still works. So, I mean, that's all I'm going to say. I just need to know what it's going to be.
So our options are?
Your options are minor plan change, amended order of conditions, or
notice of intent.
Yeah, you can do a notice of intent if you think it's. I mean, I think that's when it's, you know, it's a wholesale change. I mean, instead of a pool, we're doing a, you know, you're going to do an in-law apartment. I mean, that would be a notice of intent.
My opinion, considering knowing how we got to the approved pool configuration, my opinion is that this would be an amended order of conditions.
I would agree.
I would agree with that too.
Yep.
Okay, I'll let him know.
Didn't need to notice the fifth wheel, but.
And it would be really great to know what percentage increase it is.
Yeah, I'd like to know that.
There's a whole lot of questions we can ask him.
You know my.
There are no minutes tonight, although they were pretty short. I just couldn't get to them. Sorry, guys. So we'll have double minutes next time.
Any other business, Chuck?
We're going to MWRA's coming to town. So they're going to go down Mill Street and they're going to cut through that lot. What's the name of that? Do you know the name of that?
Lobs Mill.
Well, it's Lobs Pond, but. So anyway, somewhere in Lobs Pond or the conservation area that's next to it, they're going to go through. And we're going to have a joint meeting coming up, and I sent you an email. And we were asked to see if we can go out the 6th of September. And it's going to be at night. It's a Wednesday night. And it's specifically to hear from us and the Historical Commission about our concerns. They want to gauge the two people that have the biggest, you know, interest in this as far as it's a historical site, but it's a conservation site, has many overlapping jurisdictional areas in it, and they're probably going to tell us what they're proposing to do. Horizontal directional drilling may not be what's on the table. It seems like it's going to be more of a trench situation.
You mean like remove the bridge and dig?
I asked Ryan the engineer, maybe he doesn't know the latest proposal, but that's what he told me. He said it's likely not to be directional drilling.
And why?
Granite.
Because the pipe, the 30-inch pipe, comes in short, rigid sections, and they can't make the bend. They'd have to dig down and
you have to
bring
have
it
huge
bring it across
receiving pits and jacking pits, so it's
yeah, you have to have a big, it has to be farther a ways away to make that
They're over 100 feet away from the parking area.
Bob's Park.
Not just farther enough away, but also curving around that road, too.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd have to angle down. I'd have to do a big dig.
So he was telling me there would... But again, he hasn't looked at it or designed it, but he said he's thinking like 8 feet of cover. That's what we're talking about.
That's not that bad.
No, that's... No.
So 8 feet...
That's the trench, not the jacking and all. He said that's not...
So
that would be
hard to do. 8 feet below the riverbed?
Yeah.
And so it's just a question of how do you get there and how much damage do you do before...
I personally don't care if they go 8 feet or 397,000 feet. It's the same. I only care about the first, you know, the first 24
yeah
inches is where I'm at.
So they got about, you know, there's going to be a temporary period where they're bypassed.
Yeah.
They're,
you also have to remember this
bypass
is the same people that...
They would definitely have to bypass because the stream, according to neighbors, has not... stopped flowing this year,
oh,
like
no,
it did last.
Yeah.
It's
full of water.
Yep.
You have to remember that these are also the same people that, you know, built an aquifer that comes all the way from the Quabbin Reservoir to West Newton that you could drive a triaxle through.
Right.
So this is peanuts.
Oh, I thought you were going to say small is not in their
yeah
vocabulary.
This is a minor project for them.
8 feet, no way.
Yeah.
So I guess the thing that strikes me. One is, has anyone invited the Ipswich River Watershed Association, or do they?
They were asking for
specifically for us.
They asked for who we wanted on our list, and all those names came up.
Okay.
Cool. So it's a public meeting. It's going to be at the library. If I'll
send
so we did the Ipswich Watershed Association. There was another gentleman that's going to come that Will Finch suggested. I don't remember their names.
David Stanley?
I don't know. So, because Will's not around, but Will is a an abutter, an ex-commission member, and
historical.
It's a couple of three.
So this is September 6th at 7 p.m.?
Yeah. No, no, it's not at 7. It's at, I think they said 5:30.
5:30 p.m.?
Yeah. It's in the email, so just
did you?
I don't have my iPad with me.
I thought you just asked us when we were available. You sent an email saying
no, but it said this is the day we're looking at.
Yeah, because I thought the first one, I was going on vacation from the 8th to the 15th, so I thought it was like the 11th.
I asked if you were available between the 1st and the 15th, and I said think about this date, the 6th.
Oh. Okay.
And is it also, I mean, I think one of the things I think about, I don't know if this is relevant or not, but...
I'll send it out again and make it more clear.
The...
I don't know if I can make it clear enough for you, the sleep deprivation, but...
Fair enough.
I mean, this is one of the nice things about this, though, is it actually stops North Reading from drawing a million gallons of water a day or something like that out of the Ipswich River watershed. Right on our neighborhood. So there is some benefit there to actually getting this hooked up for our wetland and our community. So I don't think it's just about
short-term impact
of getting across the river.
I think they could design it without any impacts.
I think,
and I feel like they're kind of have the same mentality as the Tennessee Pipeline people, where it's...
Don't make us work that.
So to Dave's point, but what Chuck was really hitting on is they do very large projects. This is just a very small one, and a small one where they will probably likely they want to get in and out and think about it as little as they can.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean they shouldn't do it the right way.
Totally agree. Totally agree.
I'm hoping I can make the 6th. Hoping.
Well,
but
it's not set in stone.
Right.
If you
but
all can't make the 6th, I mean, I don't know what the Historical Commission is going to say either. So, you know,
right,
it's important that we go as a committee. So I'd like to see everyone there.
And if we do, we have to post it. All that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, all right.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Sorry. Alex.
A thing from EBI.
Yes. What was this for?
That was Hanscom Road, where
oil tank leak.
And he could look down, and I think what ended up happening was the first company, and it seems like everyone switches company, like that initial night, you have to get whoever's answering their phone.
Yeah.
But then they got someone else from Woburn, because these guys seem pretty good, and when the guy from DEP came out there, he insisted on having some tests just outside the garage door, and those came up fine. So the whole project changed at that point, where there wasn't a problem, and they just took care of what was inside the garage, which was contained, and they closed it up.
Yeah.
So it was...
it's a good result for that
home. Yeah, it was... not even, I mean, I guess if that was discovered in the first place, we wouldn't have been, you know, part of this, oh, we need a permit. But the one down on by Track Road, changing gears for a minute, I do think that we need to find out what they did. They're pretty much done over there. There's a lot of new soil, and what looks like there was a excavation all the way up to the edge of the bank. So I'm going to try to get them in on the next meeting. But we have a pretty full schedule, so might be the meeting after that.
If a site visit pops up between now
one?
And the next meeting, yeah, for that one, just call me.
Okay.
If you don't mind.
No problem.
Now I make a motion to adjourn.
I second.
You slip down.
All those in favor? Meeting adjourned. All
right, done.